Well, this happens from time to time. You are going to hear me say on this show that Adam Zampa is on the show. Pezza, is Adam Zampa on the show?
Adam Zampa is not on the show. So when Higo says that Adam Zampa is on the show, please know that he's not. I'm literally looking at a text message from him here saying that he can't make it. He has family commitments and babysitting duties, and family does come first. In fact, I have to leave in a second to go and pick up my children. So who am I to complain?
So apologies about that. We'll try and get him on another time. Anyway, it's a massive show, plenty to talk about. So let's get into it. Where else can you get Adam Zampa on a show? Where else can you get Tess Flintoff, Kim Garth in studio on the show? Where else can you get ESPN Crick Info's Matt Reller on a show? Now, individually, sure, but all together, what? That's the great cricketer this week. There's obviously a World Cup going on. Everyone is beating everyone. It's way too hot over there. There's stuff happening in the stands. People aren't allowed to wear hats into the stand. You can't bring water into the stand. But the action, oh, the action on the field, Pezza, it is red hot. Alisa Healy's got a hand bitten off by Stat Dog. Grace Harris is hitting sixes with a broken bat. That's before we get into hashtag Ask TGC, where someone is once again having an existential crisis. So much happening on the show this week, Pezza. But of course, where else better to start than our close friends at Endeavour Hills?
Ha! Well, you got to start at the grade level. I want to add to the grade level. It's a lot. Look, a bit indulgent, but there's a fucking lot happening on the show.
There's something happening on this show.
In the last 7 days. Because I want to add to what you just said there as well. We got nailed a week ago for suggesting the Afghan win over England was an upset.
Yes.
Perhaps correctly, in light of overnight events. Not really.
If only we knew.
Stat Dog dropped.
Yes.
Some people might know what that is. On our YouTube shows that we're doing reviews, it's a very, very indulgent introduction.
Aggressive.
Yes. For people listening in the morning. Our Stat Dog's also the name of Alisa Healy's dog. We landed two World Cup captains, skipper and vice skipper of the Netherlands, less than 24 hours after they knocked off South Africa.
Oh, my God.
Who are touted to meet India in the final.
Yes.
The boys told us that they literally sighted TGC like innings break before rolling South Africa.
Yes. Matthew Wade is still with us. They're nervous. We're calm.
South Africa's knocked England out of one World Cup, maybe two. On the same show where we were talking about that in Hyde Park, Sydney, a woman walked up and warned us about devil worship. If you're watching that stuff as well.
That's right.
Watto joined last week's show.
Yeah.
And that was less than 24 hours before his button started playing tug of war.
Yeah.
And on the same show, some other stuff around Godwin's law happened. That's so right. It's been a big week.
Yeah. But they get value.
Value.
There's value on this show.
More people on the show this week.
Come on. There is value on this show. Okay, but let's talk about Endeavour Hills.
Yes, Endeavour Hills.
Now, this is via the ABC. Navista De Silva has pleaded guilty to fraud after stealing 250 large from his workplace and using the money to lure international cricket players to Australia to represent his local club. You may recall this story from a couple of years ago. Chris Gayle, Dilshan, Shoaib Malik were among the cricket stars who featured for Endeavour Hills in Melbourne's Southeast competition last year. It is not suggested that any of those players were involved in the wrongdoing. People might recall that DJ Havana Brown was playing at Shepley Oval in Dandenong, one of her more esteemed gigs, I would have thought, over the years. De Silva has been released on bail and will be sentenced later this month. But, saw this one coming, Pezza?
Obviously, it's how you're going and it's in the courts and it's big time. It's real.
It's also sad for the club.
Sad for the club. Endeavour Hills Cricket Club, proud club.
I'm sure.
Good people.
I'm sure.
Club cricket, good people. Let's move past these facts.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, the eyebrows were started to be raised when you just were looking at the level of cricket it's really been.
Yeah.
You know, how are they ever able to attract
DJ Havana Brown?
Exactly. To this kind of wheelie music. Why is Endeavour Hills playing at Dandenong's first grade ground? I think these are the questions the magistrate was asking.
Yes.
You know, see, these are the thing. These are the little details the trained eye sees.
Yes.
Okay, sure, others do an actual audit of this guy and some money's gone on Louis Vuitton bags.
There's a bit of a paper trail.
And stuff. Yeah, it's paper trail stuff. Yeah. And, you know, that's when you get the experts in.
Not but for us.
If you're actually sort of, you know, a couple of detectives on the scene just sniffing about the crime scene. A
couple of great cricketers.
You go like, well, the first problem here is that this is Endeavour Hills who plays Wheelie Bin and this is at Shepley Oval.
Yeah.
Okay, that doesn't match up. Yeah. His show of Malik, he should never be playing at this level from a moral perspective.
Right.
Let alone a commercial financial one.
Two plus two does not equal five.
Exactly. Yep. And they tried to make that happen this time. Universe boss, Chris Gayle. And then there's a couple of lovely articles in the ABC linking off this fraud one as well. Some serious stuff, Chris Gayle. Anyway, this is the thing. It was like, look, a lot of cricketers club cricketers understand that there are often players who are way better than you knocking around in teams.
Quite
and you
regularly.
Ask yourself, this is a bit how you're going. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think a lot of clubs are keeping very quiet when it comes to how money is used by its leaders.
Yes.
You know,
a lot of clubs have like a real success in the pokies, for instance, and then they withdraw the cash from that. Then it sometimes ends up in good players' bank accounts.
I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes.
Sometimes. You know,
that can happen. Is that money laundering? Sure.
Yeah. I'm not hearing. The thing is, like TGC often operates as a little bit of a grapevine. You've got DMs, you've got message requests mainly. People will send you stuff. People will send you clips of guys playing badly, what our wasted Saturday show, etc. Not to be confused with cricket, etc. That's a separate issue. Yeah, RIP. As it stands, could be a Lazarus situation. I don't know.
Could be. Well, Lazarus on the show.
Yeah. Gideon was doing well to talk about what had happened at the Australian. Absolutely torched them. But then it went to some other areas.
Didn't
make the news.
Yeah.
The grapevine's strangely silent from clubs around this kind of stuff. But, no club wants to judge Endeavour Hills for the misappropriation of funds for players. And I don't know why. Okay, I'm not saying that clubs are getting Chris Gayle over.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
They don't make it too egregious, but that's all I'm saying. There's money knocking about. A lot of teams, as you say, have a lot of success at the pokies.
If you want to support TGC with your pokies winnings, you can get behind us on Patreon, where you can support us at patreon.com/greatcricketer. You can search the Patreon feed, which now goes on Spotify, or you can access it on Spotify. That's your preference. You can search TGC Patreon on Spotify. That's the feed there. You can unlock the episodes. You sign up to Patreon $5 or $10 US a month. The audio for all of our reviews after the India, Pakistan, England, and Australia games in this World Cup, which is almost every single day, in fact, this week. We've obviously had some real highlights of Australia getting pumped and Australia coming back into the tournament. Mm. Virat milking hundreds. Mm. India beating fucking everyone. England falling over. England bowling first when it was 1,000,000 degrees in the heat. The Netherlands beating South Africa. Mm. Having that interview, that's all on the Patreon feed, which, as I said earlier, you can access on Spotify. You can search TGC Patreon on Spotify.
That's how
you get it. Record numbers
Record
getting
numbers
behind
on
us. Also, you get hashtag Ask TGC Fridays every single week. I think we're up to episode 164 of those bad boys. When you sign up, you get the whole back catalogue of everything we've ever done on Patreon. Do you want to say something?
Something else you get when you sign up to Patreon, which we didn't discuss off air, pertains to news we will be announcing next week vis-a-vis Pez and Higo's doing the things that we do through the summer. And I can't say too much more other than if you sign up to Patreon, you may get yourself some early access to that thing that I'm not mentioning.
Do you know what? It's so secretive that I don't even know what Pez is talking about. No, I don't know what you're talking about. Hashtag RCTC Fridays gets into all sorts of weird areas. It's obviously an elongated program, about 45 minutes a week. We answer your looser, rawer, darker questions, themes in club cricket land. All right, Pezza, just before we get into the World Cup, there's a few bits and pieces I want to talk about here. We were extremely honoured and privileged to be asked to host the LBW Trust annual dinner at Dalton House in Sydney on Saturday night just gone. For those that don't know, the LBW Trust, they draw on the generosity of Australians to provide transformational educational opportunities for young men and women in the developing world. That's their MO, I suppose. This year, this is the second time we've been asked to do it, so we were very fortunate privileged to do it 2 years in a row. But this year, we had the great fortune of interviewing Ben Afshar and Nilab on stage to tell their story. They are two players from the Afghan women's cricket team. They escaped the Taliban in 2021 when the Taliban came back into power after the US forces left, meaning that, of course, women were not able to go to school, work, even be outside, certainly not play cricket. The story of these two young women is absolutely incredible. You know what? I'll actually link it in the description of this video or on the audio, depending on how you're consuming this. It's paywalled. It's from the Hindustan Times, but I'm sure we can find a way to skirt around that. Their story is remarkable. Close personal friend Justin Langer was also there. Good to catch up with JL.
You know, in all seriousness, that was quite linked. We were talking to JL after we had the chance to interview Ben Afshar and Nilab, and I'm sure he won't mind me quoting him, but I mean, Ben Afshar there in particular, you should read this piece that he goes, we'll link. She's 5'0".
Yep.
And she basically talked the Taliban into letting her and her entire team cross the border.
Yep.
Through 15 checkpoints. Like demonstrating a level of like toughness and profound courage that, you know, is just unimaginable. And yeah, we were talking to JL afterwards, who is a tower of his own courage in all seriousness and toughness. And he just said, like, I just love the fuck you attitude, which was like when you, and you see Ben Afshar, 5'0", her nickname's Little Devil.
Yeah.
It made sense. It was really cool. To chat with her. It was more than that. It was really an honour to speak to both of them. And then they proceeded to tell a story about playing cricket against the Governor General, and basically the Governor General's team stitch him up by calling a no ball off the last ball. That, like, Ben Afshar's like, we didn't cut the line, nor was it a waist high fully. They were the worst.
Same old Aussies.
Genuinely. Yeah.
Been in the country 5 minutes.
Yeah, David Hurley, absolute stitch up there. But really. Like a real privilege to do that with the LBW Trust.
In the same theme of charity, Pez.
We want to shout something out.
How do you want to set this up? Yeah.
I will shout something out that is taking place on November 15. We got a call a couple of weeks ago from Western Suburbs Cricket Club in Sydney. And I actually found this extremely touching. So, a little while ago, just probably over a year ago, a young man, 17-year-old, boy, Archie Gray, lost his life to brain cancer. He was a second grader at Western Suburbs, an absolute gun. And they're putting on, or they're starting a charity cricket match. We're going to talk about this for the next couple of weeks leading up to the cricket match. It's on November 15. It's called the Archie Gray Brain Cancer Awareness Celebrity Charity Cricket Match. It's raising funds for the Mark Hughes Foundation, which is an outstanding organisation raising funds in this space. It's Wests versus Manly. Both are picking their sides. It's going to be streamed on KO. We're going to talk about it over the next couple of weeks, so don't have to go into like all details at all times, but what we're asking is for people to raise money for the event, so that money will go to the Mark Hughes Foundation, and also to attend the event. It's on at Pratton Park in Ashfield, so write this down, Wednesday, 15 November. It's a night game, 5:30 till 9:30 p.m. You're going to recognise a lot of players in attendance of that game. Now, purely because of family logistical reasons, we're unable to make it to the game. But we have given we've given Wests and Manly our word that we're going to give this a massive shout out. Let me read you a little bit from the press release. Yep. So on 8 November 2022, Archie Gray lost his 11 and a half month courageous battle with brain cancer. He was just 17 years of age, an absolutely outstanding and talented cricketer for Western Suburbs Cricket Club, who described Archie as a gun. Archie, at the age of 16, debuted in second grade alongside his elder brother, Finn. He was a year 11 student at St. Patrick's College, Strathfield, and was a friend to so many within the cricketing community. His last game was against Manly at Pratton Park, and his last 4 days of life was spent at Bear College, Manly. So for this reason, two clubs have come together to create a T20 cricketing event with a mix of current players and yesteryear players to celebrate Archie's passion for cricket and continue to raise awareness for brain cancer through Mark Hughes Foundation. Just speaking to the people who are involved, I found it very touching and moving, particularly with kids of my own, but just also knowing that, I know he goes, you know, that for any of us who've played grade cricket, you know, that could be anybody.
Yeah.
And to lose a life at that age is just completely tragic. And we just want to ensure that everyone who listens to this show is aware of that and supports it as best they can. So head to Pratton Park if you can, 15 November at 5:30 p.m. Raise funds for the Mark Hughes Foundation to support the life of young Archie Gray, who I'm sure is deeply missed.
Let's now talk about the World Cup. We will be talking to both Adam Zampa and Matt Roller to give us sort of the broader themes from within one camp and also just the World Cup, generally speaking, over there in India. But since we last spoke, Australia's gone from looking absolutely abject, exhausted, unlikely to achieve anything, to now very short price favourites to make the semi-finals in the space of basically 6 days. They obviously had a tremendous win against Pakistan, to beat Sri Lanka and Pakistan. Now they've got the Netherlands on the 25th. That's tomorrow, before they play New Zealand and then England, and they finish with Afghanistan and Bangladesh. So they're on two wins at the moment. You would think that they would beat the Netherlands, though, of course, nothing is guaranteed. And I say nothing is guaranteed because since then, since last time we spoke, Afghanistan, who are now sixth, have beaten England, lost New Zealand, then beaten Pakistan overnight. So England are now 10th, which is where Australia were about 15 minutes ago. So there are no guarantees with anything, but let's make sweeping statements that no one will ever clip up or remember.
Yeah, exactly.
Remarkable. Yeah. It's remarkable.
It's that bookmarks feature now on Twitter, isn't it? You just write something that's kind of a prediction and you see there's 349 bookmarks for people waiting to fucking dunk. Absolutely dunk on you and you won't ever recover from it. Here's that time I said our team was good, but they actually turned out not to be because they lost the following match.
You're a fucking idiot.
Mate, I don't know. I feel... Middle of the World Cup, what trends and patterns can you deduce from teams, particularly given, I mean, I suppose one is that, you know, the teams from areas that are close to India are doing better in these conditions than we expected them to, and the reverse is also true.
Mm.
And it's like, wow, who would have thought that? Well, not us, dumb, obviously.
Of course.
But zooming out, I guess that's how it goes. Afghanistan got that game against Pakistan, three-pronged spin attack there at Chennai, and did the damage, restricted them with the twirlers, and got the job done, two down, absolutely did it off their dicks.
Really the only constant is India chasing, and India chasing successfully. They've won five of their five games. Now, like South Africa, who have been absolutely brilliant in three of their four games. They've beaten Sri Lanka, where they absolutely smoked them for 400. They absolutely demolished Australia in their second game. They blitzed England, scoring 399, then bowling England out for 170, forcing England into their biggest ever ODI feat. In between those two games, they lost to the Netherlands. New Zealand, they're second on the table. They absolutely blitzed England in their first game. Devon Conway, 150 in that first game. Fantastic. Beat the Netherlands, beat Bangladesh, beat Afghanistan, lost to India. Now we're like, well, they haven't really beaten anyone that good, have they, New Zealand so far? So how good are they, you know? It's really hard to make any sort of, observations of clinical observations, binary observations, but that's what we're here to do. People are like, nah, I've figured it out now. This is the final four. I've figured it out.
Yeah. There's a lot of, it's very difficult to draw conclusions about teams that haven't played the code for the last 4 years.
England, who are 10th, have Sri Lanka, India, Australia, Netherlands, Pakistan. They could win every single one of those games and they have six wins and they make the finals. Now, they could also lose some of them. They could lose all of them. There might be a draw. There could be a washout.
Scenarios.
New Zealand went off a fog the other night against India. That could happen again. I don't know. No one fucking knows. It's almost like we could be looking at the greatest upsetty World Cup of all time. Not a word, but you see what I'm getting at.
Mm.
It could be, or it could just be just India win forever. They chase runs. Kohli somehow scores 100, chasing 50 against the Netherlands. Like
top four as it stands is as we go to where is India.
New Zealand,
South Africa, Australia. As it has been pointed out that there's three massive fucking chokers in that and World Cup boss. Are we happy?
I think we're sitting pretty.
Sitting pretty. We're exactly where we want to be.
I don't see how we lose it from here, Pezzo.
3,200 round the bend. just sitting ahead of mid-pack.
Australia tonight is going to be 2 for 60, chasing 175 and thinking, oh, God.
Are they tonight?
Close.
Is it tonight?
It's tomorrow. Tomorrow night. Sorry.
Other people want to know, just a total parenthesis, just vis-a-vis your James Joyce, your Alan Joyce.
Yeah, I'm Alan Joyce.
Someone asks, is Higo's Bleeding Gums Murphy, Gary Larson, Shannon Knoll, or does he have kennel cough?
I am Stat Dog.
You are the Stat Dog.
I am the Stat Dog.
That is actually when it started. Maybe it was because of all of the work I've made you do to bark out Stat Dog.
Yeah, it could be.
Could be.
Could be.
Could be. Yeah. I don't know about, read this World Cup. I think the narrative, I mean, India are so much doing it off their dicks that they can afford to attempt to nurse Virat Kohli to 2 tons. Mm. And that's a reference to
iShow Speed.
Yeah, iShow Speed on YouTube, watched by 14-year-olds. And I suppose what their fans should be hoping for is the loss they have to have. Because if they don't, they'll be shitting bricks in the semi and the final.
We were trying to figure out when India last lost a game that meant something, because they won the Asia Cup. They did lose the
last... They lost a dead rubber to Bangladesh.
Bangladesh, exactly. Then they won the final. They bowled Sri Lanka out for 50.
Yeah.
They lost one game, the dead rubber game in the series beforehand against Australia. Yeah. So they're winning 2-0 of 3.
Then when was their last loss of consequence?
Of consequence,
was it Matt Kuhneman doing them at indoor there?
I'm not sure, but it looks imperious. It looks unimpeachable. It looks like
Daryl Mitchell impeached their middle overs.
130 of 127 in that game.
It was an impeaching.
It was wonderful. India didn't play that well. They dropped heaps of catches.
A great partnership with Rachin Ravindra. Now,
yeah, what's that about? Well, name sounds familiar, doesn't it?
Rachin Ravindra. He's parents of Indian heritage, as far as I understand. Sounds like a Kiwi. It's a familiar sounding name. I don't know. Yeah. Maybe someone could let us know where the derivation of his name. Very good player, full flowing cover drive. Mm.
Here's a question for you, Pezza. Travis Head is obviously in India. He is perhaps going to play tomorrow against the Netherlands. If not, the game after that against is it the Kiwis? Yeah, the Kiwis after that, which is 3 days after. Mm-hmm. So who makes way? Because Travis Head will open the batting. Mitch Marshall go to 3, and then you're looking at Smith, Marnus. Those only one of those two will play.
Yep.
Now, I haven't got the stats in front of me, but I have wondered over the past week or so, when was the last time I saw Steve Smith do anything in white ball cricket?
Yes.
Now, I think that Steve Smith has a much higher ceiling in white ball cricket than Steve Smith. Marnus Labuschagne, though, has been absolutely red hot. Well, red hot. He's been the best white ball player for Australia since Travis Head was out of the side, really. Mitch Marsh is obviously great. Dave Warner scored a terrific 100. But Marnus has actually been consistent since he was brought into the squad to basically replace Travis Head. It seems like it'd be outrageous to drop Steve Smith, but I don't know. It just seems like at the moment, Marnus is actually more likely to score runs.
Yeah, if you want to like...
X's and O's it.
Yeah, or like confect debate about it, you'd go, well, you know. I mean, all of a sudden, Mitch Marsh and David Warner just put on 259 at the top of the order. If it ain't broke, you know, don't fix it. And Marnus, he has superior numbers to Smith, etc. Look, Australia plays its best and most its best ODI cricket, or it has played its best ODI cricket with the setup of Head, Warner, Marsh, Smith, balanced deluxe.
Yeah. Then you go Maxwell, Stoinis, I guess Inglis would be 7, probably swap.
Yeah, does Kerry come back into calculations in that situation? Probably not, because Inglis sort of won the last game. But game before. But they play their best cricket, their most explosive cricket, when Heady comes back in. He was a linchpin of that side, obviously. They fell off a cliff once he fucking did the old Malcolm. And
Malcolm?
Meninga?
Malcolm Meninga.
Yeah.
Right.
Or is it a hand? It's a Malcolm. Yeah, it's not a German band. Mm. And then if you want to get into Smith v. Marnus, I reckon that a lot of the, you'd never be able to prove this, but like there might even have an internals component to it. Not that it'd even be discussed. You know, you have the master and the apprentice that, like, balls deep into a World Cup campaign in India,
yep.
mono e mono for who gets the that spot as the, I guess what, the rescuer of an innings, the ticket over guy.
Yep.
And I just think a lot of people will be like, well, if it's 1v1, the senior guy's going to get the gig. He's going to get it because he's Steve Smith. And yes, I also believe that Steve Smith, if they do need to go, has a higher ceiling, has yep. a greater capacity to really get on top of the bowlers if that's the situation. If you need a guy to rescue an innings, Marnus is probably in better form than Smith at the moment. I wouldn't say it's by heaps. They're probably equals as far as fielding goes. Both have different strengths in that regard. People might also regard Steve Smith as a source of leadership as well, with all the gesticulations and stuff. No, but seriously.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think in that team, Steve Smith comes before Marnus Labuschagne.
I'm just looking at your stats now. He's batted 9 times in ODIs this year, Steve Smith, 150. That was against India in September. So he scored this year 0-41, 0-74, 46, 19, 0-7. Let me get Marnus' numbers up. I apologise for the delay here, but I'm going to get it up to make my point, even though it's not going to matter because Steve Smith's going to play. But I just think it's interesting. I guess what I'm saying is I wouldn't mind seeing some higher output from Steve Smith. Okay, this year, Marnus. This year, Marnus, he's played way more games. 80 red, 124, 15, 20, 44, 39, 27, 72, 27, 46, 48.
Mm.
Look, it's not
runs.
It is runs. It's not outstanding, undroppable runs, but it's much better than the output that Steve Smith's putting out. Look, I think what you say is right. It's not really even an argument. Steve Smith's gonna play. But I just think that I want more output from Steve Smith.
I think there's a broader thematic conversation around the protection of players of reputation
yeah.
and the willingness of selectors many years out, I suppose, to create a project that is not based on guys' reputations, you know.
Like yeah.
there's probably a few bowlers who are knocking on the door as well who miss out or don't even really get a look in.
Good point.
Because there are just sacred cows in the Australian team.
Yeah.
And it does feel like the team is like, well, it's the team and the team is the team, so why would I change the team because this is the team, you know, and it just circularly reinforces itself
yeah.
all the time.
Yeah.
And I'm probably adding to that by going like, yeah, but it's Smith, you know.
yeah, yeah.
True,
yeah.
like against Marnus's numbers, but still right. So it does count for something.
Yeah.
Experience back into the tournament. Who do you want walking out?
Mm.
Someone might say, oh, the guy in form, you know, both
yeah.
pretty good.
Yeah.
But, yeah, you know, I do think that is, that's, you know, it's more courageous to say that now when Australia's still a chance of going all the way,
mm-hmm.
you know. But I do think there is something in that. In Australia, we do tend to favour the incumbent beyond what the data or stats or, the investment in the side dictates. We're going to have that conversation into the summer around Warner's spot as well, but that's not for now.
There are so many games left. I mean, Australia has the front running right now to get into the finals, but there's just so many games and so many things are going to happen since then. It's really too early to say. I just don't think England's even out of it. Finish at the moment 10th with their games left. But I do like David Warner suggesting that that umpire's stat should be on the big screen.
Yeah, now we're talking. Now we're talking.
I reckon the Aussies, their heads are just so burnt out with Joel Wilson. They've just had enough. And I couldn't really blame them. You know, I watch almost every Australian game, and I just when Joel's involved, I'm like, how's he going to do it this time?
Mm.
So it's amazing. Now, Joel Wilson, like the stats must be, because he keeps getting a gig, he must be one of the best in the world. He just has to be. But like every time I watch him,
all-timer.
Yes, I mean, he's an absolute all-timer. And you know what? I bet he's a fucking great bloke as well.
Yeah.
I'm having a go at his character. But it's like every time there seems to be something going on with big old JW there. So I don't know. But Warner's suggesting the umpire's stat should be in the screen. Fucking hell.
I mean,
it's good.
The thing is, I need to call things out. Like, you know, that after Warner was saying that in response to a dismissal that he thought was a bit how you're going, and it wasn't.
Yeah,
he was out. wasn't the one.
Yeah,
but I was still like
seen others.
And then you know, then you get other non-serial people like, well, they actually get 97% of their decisions right. It's like, does that include like calling over after six balls and stuff like that?
Yeah,
let's talk about like you know, let's find some language in cricket for umpires who. Like the percentage of dismissals that they give out when it's umpire's call, you know what I mean? And like I don't say I don't have those words myself. Someone else could do that, but like you know, I actually wouldn't mind that.
Stats being like player satisfaction of how far they stand back from the stumps.
yeah. You know, so there's a qualitative component to it as well. Social return on investment.
How far the elbows protrude when they're standing in their natural position.
Exactly.
You know, if there's a jumper involved, they hold it in the right arm, you know, in the correct arm, sorry.
Because if there's anything else we do need in sport, it's more numbers and videos attached to umpiring. It tends to assist society.
Yes.
Everybody feels happier and you end up getting better decisions and results.
What's that chat like at Square Leg? Are you happy to be standing there at Square Leg, or do you have to listen to their model train collection, discussions?
Yeah.
Discourse.
That's right. And you're not referring to a Brooklynite referring to golf courses.
No.
That's right, when they just turn up there. Yeah, I like that. Yeah, what else? Umpires, you know, how they knock on the door and say, on our way, boys, what you say after when they leave, how they actually smell, have they had a shower in the morning, some haven't. How much they want to talk to the players of promise or the higher-profile players.
Yes.
Call them by their first name. Or just call them mate, just to try and actually alpha themselves into the hierarchy.
Or elongate their first name, so Steve becomes Stephen, Patrick, or Paddy, you know, just to create some sort of familiarity.
Yeah, continue a conversation one or two sentences beyond what was appropriate because they're looking to develop some proximity, some familiarity, again, with high-profile players. All of that feeding into the bias of the opposition players, and that's before we get on to Richard Kettleborough just failing to call a wide because Virat Kohli was about to score 100.
But to be fair, to Kettleborough, when they take a wicket, when you underarm the ball to him, he does catch it one-handed cleanly like he has actually played the sport before.
Yeah, that's right. So if he takes the catch, that's all right. He goes up in your estimations. But also if there's an umpire you want to get on the side of and you know they can't catch, go up and place it in their hands. Don't quite do that because then they know that you're realising they can't catch. So maybe stand about a metre away and kind of underarm it with a pushing motion like you would a child. Ask them to get their hands out so it lobs into their hands so they feel like they've caught the ball.
These are some of the key elements that you can... manipulate to and manufacture a relationship with someone that you don't really care about.
Now, can we talk about the Kettleborough wide decision just quickly? Because I think it's very important, particularly in grade terms.
Yes.
But if you missed it, if you're a normal person, you're not watching heaps of like late night World Cup, right? There was a scenario where Virat Kohli was 5 runs away from 100 in a chase against Bangladesh. There was a lot of time to go in the game. KL Rahul had been nursing him there, not taking singles and stuff like that, so the milestone could be achieved. Other context is he's only one century away now from Sachin Tendulkar's record. That matters to some people. And
they needed two to win.
They needed two to win. Can't remember the name of the bowler. Probably good for his career. Left arm orthodox, I want to say.
Who was it against?
Bangladesh. And so two to win.
Yeah.
And he comes into bowl and it is a out and out leg side wide. and Kohli's eyes flash up to the bowler and the umpire.
How fucking
dare
you? It goes
to Richard Kettleborough, who, it must be said, is the most popular umpire on the circuit, the highest regarded umpire.
Must be said.
His stats would be good.
Good stats.
He had his fingers splayed across his face and just one of the great sports smiles where one cheek raises up to the ear, the other one doesn't do anything, and he keeps his hands down. He doesn't call the wide. That sparks a debate over the role of the umpire. Many people would say, it's a wide, call it a wide, an umpire must call it as you see it, right? At the moment you don't do that is the moment players start to get signals that some are preferred over others. The umpire is an applier of the law, of the laws of cricket, and that's all they're there to do. That's the scope of their role. Is it a wide? Yes or no? Arms out, give them the bird or not? Bird. Someone else might say, and I did hear this, I must say, on the excellent ABC, Grand State Cricket Podcast, Corbin, Middlemass, Ed Count. Corby said, just paraphrasing Corby, he's like, you know, if someone jaywalks at 2 a.m. and there's no car there, does the police pull him over and give him the full fine? Do you affect the full force of the law? You know, the umpire is an overseer of the game. Everyone wanted to see that 100. Now, I thought that was well, Ed made the point, well argued. missing out a bit for me. He's like, the full entertainment was in, the full value of the entertainment was in Kohli hitting 100 and that the bowler didn't mean to bowl a wide. Corby, he did. And I get full entertainment value from that.
Yeah.
From a great cricket perspective. That the Bangladeshi player bowling, let's get it. Can you get his name out? Like the Bangladeshi player bowling that wide is offering absolute reams of entertainment to a lot of people who've played cricket. There's Virat Kohli, 95 not out, home ground, India, about to like basically orgasm a victory with a 600 to leave India undefeated, and he goes one close to Sachin Tendulkar. It's about as good as it gets for an Indian fan. For a Bangladeshi bowler in that circumstance to go, nah, I'd rather bowl a wide and deny that to you, deny that milestone. Don't tell me that's not entertainment. Know what I'm saying?
I know exactly what you're saying. Mm. What about the time when AJ Tye bowled the wild to James Vince?
Yeah.
We're all there for that. Yeah. That was way better than watching James Vince score 100.
AJ Tye denied that he did that on purpose, which I don't think he, like, that's unfair that he's in a context where he doesn't feel like he has to do that.
Yeah.
Where he does feel he has to do that, sorry.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Shall we
can't get his name?
Shall we talk to Adam Zampa? Sorry. The player's name?
Something else, yeah.
Nassim Ahmed.
Well done, Nassim Ahmed. Anyway, Richard Kettleborough stitched you up.
Shall we talk to Adam Zampa now?
Yeah,
and then Matt Roller?
Yep.
Let's roll into it. Here he is.
So happy to have on as a first timer to this show, Matt Roller from ESPN CricInfo, assistant editor there. You may have also seen him away from those pages on The Final Word. You may have seen him back on those pages on Polite Inquiries with Vish, standing next to us once at Lord's, trying to sort of talk over the top of our stuff as well. So competitors as well. But no, in all seriousness, we've been a huge fan of Matt's work for a long time. So it's awesome to have him on the show. Coming direct from India, you're there in Bangalore. Matt Roller, welcome to The Great Cricketer.
Thanks very much, guys. Thank you for having me.
Hell of it. It's a baritone voice too. It's good. It's bass. I like it. So with that in mind, Matt, is your country, England, a shambles as a cricket team?
It's certainly not been the World Cup that most people back home expected, I think, so far. I think people came in thinking that England were probably second favourites behind India. There was a general sense that it would probably be okay, even though they've not really paid any attention to 50-over cricket for the last 4 years. And I suppose the first four games have shown that it really hasn't been okay. They've got absolutely thrashed by New Zealand in game one, which felt like been a move-on type of result. And then the last two games in Delhi and Mumbai against Afghanistan and South Africa have been pretty humbling, I think, for England to... I think after that Afghanistan game, there was a lot of talk about how they would respond and play in the right way and all this sort of thing, and how they train really well, as you often hear. And then, Butler decided to send South Africa in 38-degree heat. I think something like the third hottest day in Mumbai in October in a decade. Joe Root said it was like chewing air. That went predictably not very well. And it feels like it's a long way back from here. There's been a lot of usual talk about we've got five World Cup finals coming up, boys, but I'm not necessarily sure that it's sustainable to win five World Cup finals in a row, especially when there's no boundary count to rely on anymore.
Hey, Reece Topley is going home, Roller, with a broken digit or a fractured digit or done something to his digit. First of all, that's shocking for him because he's a ripping bloke, but he's had so many bad injuries, and now Will Carr is coming in. So can you give us a reflection on Reece Topley's luck of injuries, and is Will Carr going to win England five World Cups in a row?
Topley,
Brighton.
Terrible bad luck for him. I mean, he's been England's best bowler at this tournament, really. He didn't even start in a team against New Zealand, but he's taken eight wickets in three games, and he took two of those with his fingers literally strapped together. Had a power cut, that's good.
That's awesome. Yeah, keep going.
Well, it's scary. Yeah.
We'll plow on through. Should we do that again, or should I?
Nah, you're good, brother. Play on.
So yeah, he took two of those eight wickets with his fingers literally strapped together. So it's pretty brutal for him. Obviously, he's had a terrible run of luck, and Yeah, Bryden Carr's the replacement from Durham is right. Sort of, you know, big strapping all round, a South African born in the finest of English traditions, and gives it a whack from number eight. So, you know, I don't think he'll play against Sri Lanka in the week. There was a bit of talk, Matthew Mott said they might look for an X-Factor addition, and there was a bit of talk as to whether they would go left field and go with someone like a Jason Roy or Will Jacks, but I don't think that was ever necessarily seriously considered. I think they feel like they need six seamers at this World Cup, whoever they are. I suppose the big surprise for a lot of people would have been that it wasn't Jofra Archie, given the fact he was out here as a travelling reserve, in theory anyway, but he's left India. He was here for 3 or 4 days in Mumbai, apparently just checking in with physios on his rehab, and has gone, which, it's been a bit of an interesting one that in terms of communication, because all the chat originally in about 2 months ago was, he'll probably be named in the squad and maybe not be fit for the first few, but might be around to play a part at the back end. And suddenly the travelling reserve has travelled late and then travelled home.
Does that just mean by extension he's not as fit as they'd hoped he'd be? Because it does seem strange that you sort of name a guy and then when there's an injury you don't use him and he goes home.
Yeah, I mean, all the talk has been he's absolutely fine, progressing as planned, but there's clearly been some kind of communication problem on Archer throughout in terms of how it's been presented. I don't know whether their intention was just to keep the hope alive that he might be able to, you know, come in for a semi-final if an injury happened at the right time or whatever. But yeah, it does feel like it's not all quite gone to plan. I think he's still on course to play a pretty meaningless tour of the Caribbean in December, but we'll wait and see. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
I just heard you say a phrase at the top of the interview, Roller, where you said, they came in second favourites, I would agree with that, and they thought it would probably be okay. And I am familiar with that attitude because I feel like it's been Australia's as well, and maybe speaks to a certain kind of, casualness towards this World Cup, where two pretty senior teams who've had some success in white ball cricket of late, England appreciably more than Australia, felt like they probably had the cattle to do the business, to get themselves to the business end, and that hasn't really worked out that way. Given you're there in India, no doubt following England around, do you get it? Do you have any sense of the extent to which they've prioritised this World Cup, and whether their results are reflective of, the amount they've invested in it? Because I know from Australia's perspective, though 2-2, it certainly feels like it's the fourth or fifth order priority for the year.
Yeah, well, Joe Root did a big media briefing at England's hotel yesterday where he sort of got stuck in a bit around, the systemic issues of English 50 over cricket, and spoke about, that obviously the players haven't played almost any of it, and was talking about how much Test cricket England play compared to other countries. I think since the 2019 World Cup, England have played 56 Tests, and the next most is 39, which is India and Australia, I was actually surprised by the scale of those numbers. I suppose they kept playing in COVID when a lot of teams didn't. But yeah, in terms of ODIs, a lot of teams are playing way fewer than they ever have before. England very, very rarely, if ever, have fielded their best team between World Cups. I mean, Root played 19 ODIs between World Cups, which is almost none. And I think it has told to some extent. We've had Matthew Mott's been talking about the fact that to some extent they were guessing a little bit in selection, because it's very difficult to compare players based on Red Bull form and IPL form and stuff like that when it's only so relevant, as we've seen over the past few weeks, to 50 over cricket, which is probably more different from T20 than a lot of people remembered, I guess. Getting stuck into this big block of ODIs, you get a good reminder of just how long the days are, just how different the whole thing is. That said, I think all of the sort of systemic stuff about England not prioritising 50 over cricket, I think that's confounded when you make bad decisions at the tournament itself. So, take the game against Afghanistan in Delhi. I don't think Afghanistan beat England because they have a fantastic system which prioritizes 50 over cricket. They play less, you know, fewer ODIs than anyone else. And with respect to the, I think it's called the Green Afghanistan One Day Challenge or something like that, I don't think that the fact they're underpinned by a brilliant domestic tournament is the reason that they beat England. I think England made a bad call at the toss, bowled a load of half volleys up top and lost heavily as a result. I think, it's very easy in these situations, and I think we're quite good at doing the meltdown as an English media to sort of go back to all the systemic problems and if only this had happened and the schedule's wrong and blame the administrators. But I do think they have just made some poor decisions as well at the tournament, and players who admittedly partly because of the schedule are sort of simultaneously overcooked through playing too much all format cricket but undercooked in ODI cricket have not performed. You know, I think there's three guys who have scored 100 runs in the first four games, which is, you know, you don't win a lot of games if no one's scoring 100 runs across four games.
Matt, how do India not win the World Cup? Is the only way that the food poisoning hotel delivery goes to the wrong hotel and goes to the Indian team? Is that the only way they can not win the World Cup?
I think the most enjoyable way for India to not win the World Cup would that for them to go 9 from 9 in the group stage, chasing in every single game,
yeah,
and then get sent in and shit the bed basically in the semi-final. Yeah. It feels like they're a seriously good team, and obviously that performance against New Zealand, overcoming the injury to Hardik and bringing guys like Surya and Mohammad Shami off the bench, is pretty useful. I suppose, yeah, I don't know. I don't really see how they don't, to be honest. I think they seem so much more complete aside than everyone else. And I think particularly their attack is so much better than everyone else's, that it's pretty hard to see. I suppose, you know, it will be harder if Hardik doesn't come back, but I think he probably will. I feel like they're strong favorites at the moment. I feel like it's going to take something pretty spectacular to happen. I mean, I suppose the you know, again, different format, but the Adelaide semi-final is probably the blueprint as to how they don't, where, you know, it's much easier to play attacking fearless cricket when you're chasing a total under 300 and you know, your strong favorites are halfway, than it is when you've got the pressure of this massive country telling you you've got to beat whoever it is in the semi-final and set up a final at the stadium named after your prime minister and all this stuff. So maybe that's the route, but I think they're going to do it, to be honest.
Roller, I'm keen to know what you think, particularly being on the ground there. And I know that you've spent a lot of time in India before. You've covered the IPL from the ground in India, which I think is... it's not something a lot of people in the, call it the Anglosphere of cricket journalism, have done before. You've got genuine runs on the board in covering cricket over in India, getting a feel of the game there, what the priorities are and aren't, as well as in England and Australia. I note in your last piece, it at least started with the widespread view that ODIs are dying a slow and painful death has not been rebuffed in the first 2.5 weeks of the World Cup in India. Now, you go on to explain what that means. I want to add that into Greg Baum from the Nine Papers writing a piece overnight saying that this World Cup has been a fan-free zone, not blaming fans in any way, but rather access to tickets, that lots of people would like to go but haven't been able to access tickets. You know, what is there freedom to make critiques of this World Cup? And if so, what would they be? Do you get the sense in India that the World Cup is being enjoyed by the fans there? And what has your experience of it been? Do you think we're looking at one of the greats?
I think that the tournament so far, as I said yesterday, has been basically characterized by the empty seats and the lack of close finishes. We got the closest finish of the tournament last night, where Afghanistan won by 8 wickets with an over to spare. That was as close as it's got to a last over thriller, which ended up being an absolute cruise. I feel like there's not really been a good game. The slogan that the ICC have for this World Cup is "It takes one day," which I feel was presumably dreamt up by someone in marketing who didn't think, "Fuck, one day is a really long time." honestly, you know, you can spend 8 hours watching Sri Lanka squeeze past the Netherlands in Lucknow. You can, you know, you can fly to, I could fly home and have a Sunday lunch with my girlfriend if I wanted to in a day. But it feels like it's been a bit of a drag, to be honest, the first 2.5 weeks of this tournament to me. I think that the fans is the frustrating thing, because we know that so much of cricket's economy is driven by broadcast money. And realistically, the revenue from ticket sales is such a small part of it in this World Cup. And yet the product for broadcasts, to use a pretty, you know, one of those horrible marketing words, I feel is massively diminished by the fact that there's empty seats there the whole time. It looks worse because of the fact there's no fans there. And it would be really, really easy for them to make the whole process of tickets and getting fans into grounds a lot easier and a lot better than it is. You know, you have these, I have a friend who went to the opening game in Ahmedabad as a spectator. He rocked up with a QR code at the game half an hour before it started, thinking this will be absolutely fine. He got told that he had to go to a hotel 2 miles away to get his QR code scanned and pick up a physical ticket. So he did that, came back, then got told he wasn't allowed to bring his bag in. And his bag had some sort of broadcasting equipment, like a camera or a selfie stick or something like that. And so then he had to go back to his own hotel, put his bag back and come back in. And having arrived at the ground originally before the start, he got there in something like the 45th over of the first innings, was when he actually got to his seat. And you hear so many stories about that from fans on the ground. There's not many of them here, but whenever you speak to someone, there's, you know, oh yeah, my sun cream got confiscated. You know, I wasn't allowed to bring in my bottle of water, all this stuff. And it just massively diminishes the whole fan experience, because as we've seen, in, especially in the big cities, there is a genuine appetite to go to games. It's not like you ever see, especially in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, it's not like you ever see empty seats at IPL games. But if it feels like a combination of it being in working hours, a lot of games being midweek, and the fact that a lot of tickets are prohibitively expensive, means that people just aren't that interested. If you want to get a crowd in for a fairly, you know, a smaller game that doesn't involve India, there is still appetite for people to come, I think. But you need to actually try and get them in. You can't release the schedule 6 weeks before and say, can you pay us 40 quid to come and watch this game in a premium seat? It just doesn't work like that. So I feel like that's been a massive issue. That said, all the streaming numbers are really good, apparently. So maybe it's all fine. But I feel like that's heavily reliant on India games. And yeah, to me, it has felt like it hasn't necessarily felt like a format that's in any real health.
Are you only saying that because England's losing?
Yeah.
How do the Trent Rockets look?
I'm going to... I'm going to keep doing what I've been told to do a lot in the replies on Twitter, and we'll continue to cry more over the next few
years. Please, we could all do it. Could we do it together?
Yeah. Tears across the world. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Just back to the teams, Roller. The same question about two different teams. Is New Zealand good? And is South Africa good?
I think they're both good. I think New Zealand I did the classic New Zealand thing. I watched them lose to England in September, and I thought these guys are rubbish. So I thought there's no chance they're getting the semifinals. And whenever I did preview podcasts and predictions and stuff like that, I was saying, nah, I don't think the Kiwis will do it this time. So they start 4-0. I think they'll get to the semis. I don't know whether they'll win it. I think they're a pretty good side, though. I think that I like what they've done with the balance. I thought they were going to go a lot more conservative and have Santner at seven, but they picked the extra bat, and it seems to be working quite nicely for them. South Africa, who the fuck knows? Honestly, it's been a classic South African World Cup where they look $1 million and also complete pony. I think both of them are teams that will probably be in the shakeup for the semis. I think they probably both should make the semis from where they are. I don't think either of them should beat India in the semis. I don't think that's, you know, I think if you were doing like a power rankings of the World Cup, I think you'd have India and then daylight. But I suppose that's the great thing about the fact that we still have semi-finals and not a repechage system, and the fact that, you know, you can have as long a group stage as you want, but if you still have knockout cricket, random shit happens. So who knows? Maybe I tell you what, that would not be good for the health of the format as a whole. If we had a New Zealand South Africa final at the Modi, I think there would be about 15 people in there, wouldn't
it? Okay, here's a final thought for you, Roller. Let me see what let me test these waters. Australia's shit, but they'll probably make the final.
I don't think they're as shit as I think every Australian thinks they are. I think they're all right, but yeah, I think that game against Pakistan was clearly pretty helpful for getting them back on course, not least because they won. But I think I think playing at grounds like the Chinnaswamy is pretty good for Australia. I think it was a bit of a tough draw, to be fair, for the Aussies starting off in Chennai and Lucknow, probably not pitches that are going to suit them. I think they're okay. I think you're basically spot on. I think Head coming back's a big boost of, you know, Marsh and Warner in the runs. You can see how it all fits together, can't you? Even though they, like England, they're not prioritised the format. Like England, they're relying on players who are pretty cooked, probably after an Ashes summer still. I can see how it all comes together for them.
Mm.
Any interest in touching on some Bairstow quotes from overnight, or are you as bored of it as we are?
Do your worst.
Nah, I'm looking at this, like some quotes from Bairstow have come out ahead of a book called Bazball. Perhaps you know more about it, but it's being presented in the media now as Bairstow continuing the conversation about what happened at Lord's, the reality being he was interviewed before the Oval, but that doesn't matter if you're online. It's just a continuation and a further reinforcing of the idea that, you know, everyone else is wrong, depending on which side you're on.
Yeah, basically. I mean, Bairstow's had a terrible World Cup, so maybe he needs to get into the mindset of everyone hates me, the world's against me, and that'll sort him out, and he'll rattle off five hundreds in these five World Cup finals, and then England get to the World Cup semi-final.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, there's all these options out there. Like, you know, guys could go well, guys couldn't. Teams could win, they might not win. It's very pitch
there's
dependent.
So many games.
So many games to go. Analysis is unneeded. And then, you know, the ICC are going to meet after the whole tournament and discuss the future of it anyway. So, Matt Roller, thank you so much, my brother. It's been great to have you on. We'd love to have you on again right there from India. You're in Bangalore. Catch up with Matt's work on ESPN and everywhere else. He's a gun. I really appreciate it, mate.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Thank you very much to the boys there over there in India. We are about to talk to Kim Garth and Tess Flintoff, but before then, Pez, a couple of bits of information about Australian domestic cricket. So this is via Dan Bredigan, The Age, and of course the SMH, in fact the Channel 9 papers. Pat Cummins and Marnus Labuschagne have accepted 3-year Cricket Australia contracts, and 2-year deals have been handed to 6 others as T20 franchises continue to circle around the world's top cricket talents. Dan says the willingness of CA to offer as many as 8 multi-year deals to players seen as key performers across numerous formats is a sign of the times. So, Cricket Australia's multi-year deals, 3-year deals for Cummo and Marnus, 2-year contracts to Head, Smith, Cam Green, Stark, Carey, Hazelwood. It's interesting. It's interesting that those players are signing up for longer-term deals. Like a 2-year deal is very rare. 3-year deal is unheard of. What's happening? World cricket, generally speaking, franchise cricket's the future.
Well,
Olympics coming up.
I'd say gauntlet thrown down.
It's a gauntlet
to the IPL in Saudi Arabia. I'd say game, set, match.
Yeah,
Cricket Australia.
Checkmate.
Just checkmate.
Checkmate.
Checkmate. IPL.
We gotta come over 3 years.
Yeah,
we got the bin lid for a couple. Good luck.
You're gonna make a couple mil over 12 months, boys. What do you think about that? And then someone else comes along and goes, "You can make the same in 6 weeks." How about we test that bad boy out in court?
Yeah.
But I do think it's an interesting manoeuvre. Is it signalling some kind of response, some kind of pushback from, you know, at least the Cricket Australia administration, and I know the ECB have done this as well, but, you know, people defending international cricket against just the steamroller wealth of domestic franchise T20 cricket. I mean, there are no doubt within those contracts clauses where you can go and play that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But I still think there's like more massive dramas to come in terms of the kind of money and the manoeuvres that may be made by these franchises to trigger a choice, trigger a choice for players, whether it moves away from getting permission from your international team and towards getting permission from your domestic team to play.
Only 6 months ago, a little bit more than that, it was reported that Jofra Archer was about to accept a 10-year deal with the Mumbai Indians. 10-year contract. That's better than three. Mm. I mean, I think you're exactly right, mate. But it is interesting. Is this the first move we're seeing for someone in global cricket to actually try and preserve international cricket? Mm. I don't know. The ACA have been supporting netball. This is via the ABC News. Australia's cricketers have thrown their weight behind the country's netballers amid a bitter pay dispute with Netball Australia, creating an unprecedented financial fund to help support those players. So it's been reported that the ACA have put approximately $200,000 into this fund. This is ACA, that's the Australian Cricketers Association CEO Todd Greenberg, friend of the show. Much like our female players in 2017, the netballers at the moment are leaning on friends and family for financial support. What is disappointing is that the netballers' requests are modest and affordable for the sport. The ACA believes they should be given the same partnership opportunities as our players, the same opportunities that have seen cricket thrive. This is Todd talking. The ACA stands with the netballers and will do so until this campaign is successful. Now, Pezza, as we've learnt recently, that if you go woke, you go broke. So
that's true.
This is a massive mistake for all involved.
Yeah.
Disappointing to see.
Isn't it? Why are we giving them a hand? Good solidarity. Very curious as to the strategic driver for it. I wouldn't, like, for a second believe that any organisation would do something like that for like pure altruism.
Yeah.
Be kind of, yeah, it'd be jarring if they did, and that would be sad that it would be jarring. But I can only, like, I'm purely speculating that there must be some strategic alignment or, news ahead for the kinds of scenarios that they're keen to see in terms of guaranteeing pay.
So, you think it would be more than just an optic? Though, of course, that is sad. Sad affairs, but
Elisa Healy spoke on Offside really passionately about this as well. So a lot of people are behind. I wonder. The ACA is a member organisation as well. I do wonder, like, how many of the members or the percentage of members who support that or are across it. But I do think Todd Greenberg's earned a lot of credibility through his time there.
And
supported. So I'm very curious as to like what it is laddering up to. But, I think well done on supporting.
IPL deals for the netballers, I reckon. We were very fortunate and privileged to have Kim Garth and Tess Flintoff, a couple of the WBBL stars, indeed of the Melbourne Stars, in the studio here this morning. They've got a game tonight, actually. In fact, when you listen to this or watching this, they're probably playing right now.
Mm.
So why do they do this? I don't know. I guess we should ask them right now.
That's not before we let you know that the interview is brought to you by winning the inner battle.
Ah, yes.
By old Tug of War himself.
Tugger.
Tug of War buttons.
I saw what I speak about this on an interview, so it's good.
Yeah. He owned it. He owned it, which is good. Yeah. It was also what.
I'm just not feeling as beach ready as other people seem to be on the internet to, you know, just about the state of the rig. I mean, you know, whisper it quietly. I think Watto's actually is in pretty good rig. I think he's been, he's like, the angle has done him a disservice. The tailoring has done him a disservice. I think he's in all right shape. I'm just reticent at this stage in late October. I'm not feeling beach ready myself right now.
Yep.
So I'm going to just call my jets a little bit about being like,
Are you issuing a call out to the commenters to call their jets?
No, I'm not saying anything. Mm. I'm fucking do whatever you want.
Yeah.
And you know what? They probably will.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, for me, if people are looking for me to, you know, have a go, I'm just saying, like, I'm not feeling that body confident right now, you know?
Please. Winning the inner battle is making like waves throughout cricket. It continues to make waves throughout cricket. Look at who's on the book itself. He goes, you got Faf du Plessis, Ricky Ponting, and Binger. Now,
talk about elite. First thing I want to say,
now there's a circuit.
Exactly. That fucking hell. Now you're getting into like ultimate dinner guest party. You know? Yeah. Obviously Bradman and Benno's there.
Well, we've already gone through join Patreon if you want to know how that dinner party went. We had a hypothetical dinner party with Richie Beno and Don Bradman, and fuck me, it took off. Arguably inappropriately, but it still did. Guys are under lampshades. All sorts of stuff was going on.
Fuff, Hunter, yeah, Binger.
I
call Binger an elite bush.
Watto needs to be there because Watto's the glue between the... Watto's great...
he's the conduit.
..pals with all these guys.
Yes.
So, and... Faf actually says on the book, to this day, I still use it before every game. And we know that's not dross, because there's young players coming through as well who like basically turn to this book. It is becoming the book of choice for pro cricketers. Mm-hmm. Train your skills, train your body. Now it's time to train your mind, Ricky Ponting. And Binger says, simple process to be able to use in all aspects of life. You can see through Watto's commentary through the World Cup, which has been exemplary, that he just comes out with these little nuggets every so often that shows like a very high level of awareness of how white ball cricket works.
Yep.
Not forgetting he's one of the great white ball players in Australian history.
Yep.
Who got better as his game went on. So, you know, with Watto, you're looking at somebody who has actualized all of their talents, both physical and mental, towards the end of his career. And he's basically alchemized it all, he's synchronized it all into one book for anybody who wants to get better at cricket at any level. So that's winning the battle. We get that at shanewatson.au.
Here they are. You're a Kim and Tess.
We're joined by two stars of the women's game here in studio. Irish-Australian international, if I can call you that, Kim Garth, record-breaking Tess Flintoff, both of the Melbourne Stars. First time on the show for both. Kim, Tess, welcome to The Grade Cricketer.
Thank you for having us. This is great. We love this place already.
Well, I want to say thanks for starters. Like, we're recording on Tuesday morning. The Melbourne Stars are literally playing this afternoon. We've interviewed a lot of people over our time. No one's actually joined the show on the morning of a game. So why are you here?
You pestered me for the last 2 weeks and gave me a day's notice. So I said, look, next Tuesday, we're free. And we had an early night on Saturday night. Mm-hmm. We had an early finish, so get a bit more rest.
So with the game this afternoon,
the early finish. Yeah,
yeah. I was going to say, what's the batting order going to be, and what's the pitch looking like?
I believe.
Don't answer that question.
Don't.
Oh yeah. It's not live.
Well, I guess let's just jump straight into it. Mm. After having booked you guys for the show, Melbourne Stars players a week ago, then waking up the other day, learning that you'd been rolled for 29.
Yeah.
We were both like, oh, sensational.
Perfect.
It was 24, wasn't it?
It's 29.
Oh.
29. Yeah, look at that. Yeah. Attention to detail.
It could have been a disaster.
Yeah.
It could have been a real, real disaster. Five less.
Just reflections on getting rolled for 29, firstly, and then secondly, Tess, you weren't playing, so fantastic feeling.
What a
sensational
result.
Feeling for you. Mm. In the sheds as well, just like, sakes, any danger?
It was great. Yeah, no responsibility. I'm sure the girls weren't too happy, but...
I saw you appealing at one point. I thought that was a bit far.
Yeah. It was an interesting game, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Kimmy, what did you think?
Yeah.
You didn't get any?
Nah, didn't make any. Decided to... run with that leggy, third ball. And yeah, that was the end of me. But yeah, look, it was pretty quick. It was we had a laugh about it after the game. There was a couple of blokes in the rooms, actually. It was pretty funny. I was like packing my kid away and this bat just came flying next to my ear.
Oh, sick.
I'm sure you can guess who that was. And there's a few blokes and then we end up just sitting on the bench and chuckling quite hard.
Who was that? Can you say who the blow-up was?
You don't have to if you don't want to.
There was two. Do you want... I feel like you should guess.
You don't have to if you don't. But I need to know who's angry.
Was Nicole one of them?
Yeah.
Classic.
Yeah. Nicole, yeah, and then Reese wasn't as big, but she was.
Really?
Yeah. Anyway, it was. We saw the funny side of it in the end. What can you do? You can't really dwell on that too much. But here we are playing them again, the Sarvo. So soon. By the time the show airs, will we have played them? Yes.
Yeah. It'll be around there.
The game will be on.
Yeah. So make all of your predictions and stuff now, so when people are listening. You've been rolled for 23 now.
We'll make more than 29.
Yeah.
Okay, you've got a hamstring injury at the moment, don't you, Tess?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Okay.
Yeah.
Out for a little while longer?
Yeah, see how we go.
Okay.
Don't give too much away.
That's coy.
Yeah, feeling pretty good though, so.
How are you feeling generally about, like, because you are 20 now, is that right?
That's correct.
And you're doing, like, headshots day with Channel 7, you're in the adverts, you are, to quote Zoolander, you are so hot right now, you know? I think that movie was made before you were born, but...
Never heard of it.
Yeah. That's good, you should watch it. It's in black and white, but you're past that. It's also a Charlie Chaplin movie. Indeed.
Sorry.
Anyway, how are you finding, like, the spotlight? Because you broke the record last year at North Sydney Oval for... you scored a 50 in how many balls?
16.
16 rocks. Yes, you do. You do remember. Why are you lying?
You're coy.
16 balls. You can count to 16.
Just.
But then since then, you've been in the spotlight. So how are you finding it? It's pretty 0 to 100.
Like here in the studio and stuff with the great cricketer boys and that.
Yeah, it must mean a lot to you to be here.
Pretty big step, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Dream come true.
Yeah.
It's okay. I don't know. It doesn't really faze me too much. You kind of forget, like, about cameras and stuff when you're playing and all that, so it doesn't really bother me. I haven't really done much since the 50, so it hasn't been that much long, lot. But I remember actually going through the comments after that happened, and one of them said, "Not bad for a bowler," so that just
good,
perfect,
brought me back down to earth. So yeah, no, it's okay. I don't mind the camera, so not that bothered.
You took down Shooter and Darcy Brown. His last two overs, that would have felt good.
It was good fun. Kimmy actually ran herself out for me.
I was going to ask about Kim.
I haven't actually publicly thanked you for that.
Oh yeah,
so
sacrifice. But you guys were batting together. Obviously, you've made it's the WBBL world record 50 off 16 rocks, and say rocks just kind of sound cool, but they're just balls. And at North Sydney Oval there, Kim, you were batting with Tess at the time, last couple of overs, and what's the chat? Do you remember the chat in between overs going into the last over? What was said?
I think I said, "I'm coming back for two no matter what." No, I said, "I'm coming back for two unless you literally hit it straight to a fielder." And then you hit it straight to a fielder.
So I was just jogging and then Kim's just sprinting at me. So I thought, get the hell out of her way.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was really beautiful.
And then I wasn't actually there for the last over because I ran myself out. But.
Can we actually hold the strike in the second over of the surge? But you got it. You got.
I got 11 off 8. I was actually really pleased with that. Over run a ball. Tick.
It was actually kind of your day in the end, wasn't it?
Yeah, really. Yeah. If anything.
It was a selfless run out and 11 off 8, and probably I reckon none for maybe 33 off 4. So
take that.
So specific.
And a win.
Yeah, and a dub. So.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of both of you guys being good, record holder 50 Australian international top wicket taker in the WBPL last year, at least for Gujarat, and so. I just looked at an article published last week by Lachlan McCurdy, friend of the show, naming the top 30 WBBL players this year. No Tess, no Kim, Kim G.
No
is that
top 30?
Top 30.
That's a bit awkward. Who was number one?
All right. I thought you might. I thought you'd never ask.
Well, how did we miss
this? So one, and I want your reaction to this. Ash Gardner, one.
Fair. That's fair.
Hayley Matthews too.
Foreign player. I wouldn't. I disagree with that. Don't you reckon? Like, she's had an unreal year, but number two overall WBBL. No, I'm not covering that.
Curious about your views on the next player, Nat Siver-Brunt.
I'd have her at number two.
Yeah.
Good player.
Can play.
Now Nat was due to play for the Stars this season, wasn't she?
We get into this, are we?
Yeah. Ask Meg.
Yeah, ask Meg.
Background. Meg already said her comments, but the background being that, so Nat Siver-Brunt, world-class player globally, That's, I guess that's inferred by saying world class, but
I go even further. I think she's one of the best in the world.
Yeah, that's right. On earth. Globally, and yeah, around, and that's around
on God's
the globe.
Green earth.
Yeah. She played for the Melbourne Stars a couple of seasons ago, and then that meant that if she was going to go into the draft, like everyone else goes into the draft, Melbourne Stars would have had a retention pick there. I'm sort of pretty nerdy about draft stuff. I'm a footy and stuff.
Yeah. And some of Rubik's Cube.
But she actually, Nat withdrew, made herself unavailable for the draft on the basis of a knee injury, which she promptly recovered from straight after the draft and was picked up by the Scorchers. Meg Lanning had a few comments about that. You guys missing Nat from the team?
Pretty happy with our list.
Yeah. Yeah.
Good player. Let's be clear. Good player.
Good player.
Now at the Scorchers.
Yeah.
How did the franchise?
I can see why Meg would be aggrieved of that.
Mm. It's a great word.
Why Meg would be? You guys are fine with it.
Word,
yeah, but it's sort of Meg's.
I wouldn't want to be the subject of Meg Lanning being aggrieved.
Mm.
Having
yeah, neither would I. Oh,
yeah, there's a real look in the eyes with Meg Lanning, isn't there?
There's eyes.
Yeah, there's eyes.
We actually saw Meg.
We got those eyes this morning.
Yeah.
Oh really? Good wife for doing this.
She was walking a dog and we tooted
the hell out of her. Yeah. Scared her.
We rattled her. Really? She said, make sure you give me a shout out on the show.
Yeah. Here we are.
I think she wants to come on, actually.
Yeah, she's been on.
Yeah. Oh, is she?
Meg's been on the show.
She said she's keen to come on again, actually.
Okay, he's stitching her up again. I can sense this is what's going on.
Yeah, she's keen.
I don't want to go through all the... Talia McGrath's 4.
Mm, fair.
Happy? Mm, Marizanne yeah. Cap?
Oh, Cap. I reckon Cappy's BBL goat. Everywhere she goes, she wins.
Okay.
She's free.
Bats, bowls, fields.
How is Elise Perry not in the top 5?
Amelia Kerr is 6 and then Elise Perry 7.
Who wrote this article?
Well, Lachie McCurdy, he's good. He's good to go. He's right. Probably just also...
Where the hell's Kimmy?
this is what I looked at. No, Kim G.
Were there notable mentions?
31st.
Top 30. Oh, no, look, he does say there's a lot of international stars who are missing from this. So probably not even referring to you again, Kimmy, as a naturalised Australian. Yeah. Seth Mooney, 8. Sophie Devine, 9. Phoebe Lichfield, 10. Oh, Meg Lanning, 11.
What? Sorry.
Yeah, now we're talking.
Here we go. Come on.
Okay, I reckon this is going on form. If it's going on form, I'm absolutely happy with it, delighted with it. But if it's going overall Big Bash history, I'm not sure about it.
You're in there? Is that what you're saying?
No. I'm definitely not putting myself in there. I just think
in the top 30, you are.
No.
Oh, I'll put you in there.
Fine, 29
that's
maybe.
Cool. Yeah, that's right. Sort of low 20s. Annabelle Sutherland, 12. Oh, yeah. Lisa Healy, 13.
Interesting.
Darcy, I'd
up there in the top 10, I reckon, current form.
Who's at 25, curiosity?
Yeah, here we go. Let's go sort of more controversial selection. So 20, Alana King. 21, Jess Johnson. 22, Megan Schutt. 23, Laura Harris. 24, Tammy Beaumont.
When was the last time she played in the Big Bash? Tammy Beaumont. Come on, stats guru.
Tammy was last, yeah. Oh, she finished our last year. You with 290 runs at 41.
How'd you hit him? At what pace did you hit him at, Pez?
Yeah,
strike him?
Yeah. 25, Heather Graham. 26, that. Amanda Jade Wellington. 27, Heather Knight. 28, Aaron Burns. 29, Alice Capsey. 30, Elise Villani.
Oh, I reckon June, all time. June's got to be up there. Do you reckon we could write to, is it Lachlan?
Yeah.
Can we have a redraft?
We just get some clarification on the criteria that he's going off.
Yeah.
Like overall,
good players though.
Overall form. Absolutely good players. But if we're going overall, as I said, Big Bash history, I think he's got it all wrong.
Good.
We don't feel strongly about it though.
No. I can feel
rankings don't tend to create differences of opinion either. No, it's just no. That's just what the rankings are.
No. It's also like player ratings at the end of a game. Just like, how could you give someone a 6 out of 10? They're actually a 6.5.
Mm.
You know, that kind of stuff. Mm. Kim, you would have Elisa Healy's phone number in your phone, I suspect.
Yep.
There's obviously a couple of days ago, was it yesterday happened? I've lost all track of time. That she fucked her hand up pretty bad, basically, right? There was blood everywhere. Got in the middle of a dog fight.
Crime scene.
It was a crime scene, apparently. Have you spoken to her at all?
I sent her a text straight away. I said, what the fuck, Midge? Are you okay? Sending love. And she said, all good. Thanks, Kimmy. X.
Thank you.
So I didn't get much from her.
Yeah, okay.
Journos, listen, that's the...
It's good effort for her to text back, given she had half a hand.
Yeah, no, it was the next day, but
Oh, so she was fine by then.
Yeah. No, I think she was fine by then. Just not really. I'm a bit sad with my 12-hour response time.
Yeah, okay.
It's a bit like when you text Tess, actually, it takes three business days for her to get back. Now that
you're not good with your phone.
I'd like to think I'm pretty good, but...
Well, apparently you're not. Why are you brushing Kim? What's going on?
Yeah, what's happening?
Is there a rift in the Stars dressing room?
She scares me.
Yeah, I get that vibe.
We are
such good friends. It's actually great. We've become really tight over the last little bit.
You guys actually wanted to make clear that there's not as much distance between you as there is on the couch at the moment.
Mm, this is forced distance.
Tess
basically lives with me, don't you?
Yeah,
production reasons.
Kim's actually on a Zoom call at the moment. It just looks like she's next to you.
Nice catch.
Yeah. It's a good catch, actually.
Well, Tess, you only sort of started following us the other day Insta.
Is that right?
Yeah.
What did we do?
Are we sure? Yeah.
Was that actively avoiding? Because we're sort of on socials a fair bit. Was it just hadn't earned the follow until the call up to this?
What's going on?
Yeah, this is a little bit uncomfortable, isn't it? No, I love the great cricketer. I do.
Someone clip that up.
Yeah.
Big fan of the show. Yeah. Sorry about that. We're friends now, though, so made up for it.
We'll decide. Kim, I want to talk to you about your experience for Gujarat at the WPL, obviously the inaugural WPL last year.
Are you guys holding hands over there?
Don't you reckon we can if you want.
Not yet. We often do.
Sorry.
Beautiful. You guys hold hands, we'll hold hands.
Sorry to get across here.
It actually somehow makes the internet connection stronger here, which is weird. but I've got a chip in my brain.
Ask the whole question, we'll hold hands.
Yeah.
I hope there's a camera on.
You can see they're on.
They're hiding
behind. I'm now going to read.
Swallowing me.
I'm tickling your elbows again. Can you tell us about your experience playing in India for Gujarat? How was it? Did you have a good time? Poles? Yep. It's good?
Yep. A couple of poles. It was nice. Yeah, it was really good. It was really cool.
Yeah.
The whole thing was really cool to be part of. And yeah. Yeah, it was good fun.
Actually, like massive crowds as well, like good energy with the teams, like everyone's excited for it.
Yeah, for sure, especially the first edition. It was really cool. Just even like the opening ceremony was just next level crazy. Like,
what was that? I didn't see that. You didn't. What was the opening ceremony?
It was like they had like this Bollywood rapper.
Oh yeah, okay.
And then this like Bollywood actress / singer and like a million backup dancers and they actually had to push the game back till something ridiculous like 8:30 just because to get all their shit together. But it was really cool. Like the whole thing was cool. We weren't very good, sadly, so that was a bit of a downer. But it was really cool to be part of. And yeah, obviously, all the best players in the world just kind of coming together at once. And some really good games in there, so it was cool.
Yeah. So you've told us off camera that you've been released from Gujarat.
I have.
So what's going on with that? Like, are you going to get picked up by someone else?
I mean, I hope so. I'll put myself back in the draft, put myself out there. But by the looks of a lot of the teams, I think a lot of them have, like, kind of kept most... It was only really Gujarat that did a big clear out.
Yeah.
I mean, look, I'm hopeful to get picked back up again. But if not, then a bit of time at home.
Yeah.
Well, you... For people who wouldn't know your story listening to this show, Kim, like you've chased the professional cricket dream from Ireland. You debuted for Ireland when you were 14. Your mum and your dad played for Ireland. It's your younger brother's Ireland A.
You did do some good Googling before this.
Is it? I hope you wrote it in and none of this is true. No, I know that.
Yeah, of course.
Older brother clubbies.
he's probably the best of a lot of us. Anyway, continue.
That's easy to say when you play for Australia in the WPL. But how's that journey been? You know, to chase professional cricket, to leave Ireland, presumably, which is home for you in your heart, and to come out here and to chase it.
Yeah, it's been crazy. It's been crazy few years. I guess I left, kind of made the decision just before COVID. Got offered a contract with Victoria and then spent 3 years not playing for Ireland. And then, yeah, my goal was obviously just to qualify as a local player and just give me a bit more confidence that I could get picked up in the Big Bash and WNCL as well. Kind of just... through some good domestic performances, kind of went from there. So, it wasn't an easy decision, I guess, leaving Ireland and leaving home. But, it's been a crazy couple of years and it's been good.
Why, this is an extremely ignorant question. And also, please pick us up on any ignorant stuff, like hammer us for it. A lot of players who leave countries to join another country go to England. We are English, half the English team, at least in the men's, is usually from another country. Yeah. Why England's closer to Ireland? Why not there? Why Australia?
At the time when I left, the domestic system in England wasn't as good as it is now. And
do you regret that then?
No, not at all. Also, I'd spent a couple of years playing Greek cricket in Melbourne as well, so I kind of had a bit of a base. And yeah, it's a good lifestyle. So it's a lifestyle kind of decision. Well, mainly cricket, but the lifestyle definitely played.
And you've made the Australian team, like you're a permanent fixture in it now. Cross formats, like, I mean, you must have really backed yourself as well with the Aussies. The Aussies.
It's the greatest team of all time.
It's the greatest team of all time. It's the only team giving us safety. I don't know why the Matildas are getting statues, finished fourth.
Yeah, what's with that?
Yeah. And you've come over from Ireland. Australians would just be looking down their nose at Irish cricket. Let's just be real about it.
Yep. Yeah.
And you've obviously just backed yourself and gone, oh, I can make this team.
It wasn't really my thought process. My thought process was I'll just come over because I didn't really want to work in an office. So I was like, fuck it, I'll just move and – yeah, try and play cricket as a job, and then I kind of went from there. But having said that, yeah, it's been pretty cool to once I qualified to get into the squad straight away, and played a handful of games since then. So it's pretty cool team to be part of.
So you didn't want to work in an office, so you just play cricket for Australia. Kim, the arrogance of you to sit here in the great cricket studio. Tess, I want to ask you, you were in Europe, apparently, and then you just got called up to play for Australia in Ireland, in Dublin, is that right? After that, then you got picked up by the Phoenix to replace Elise Perry in the 100. That's all in the space of like 2 weeks, isn't it?
Yeah, it was wild.
So why were you in Europe in the first place? Explain yourself.
I was in England for an A tour.
Okay.
And then we had a bit of time off after that. So Nicole Fulton and myself went on a little holiday in Europe for a few weeks.
Back of your mind is thinking, well, I'm in next cab.
Kim says yes. Yeah.
I didn't have a single thought about it.
So you just happened to be doing, you know, yacht week in Croatia and you're just like, well.
I was living my best life in Barcelona and.
Dragging your kid around?
Yeah.
I sent my cricket stuff
home. With the wheels going down.
Yeah.
There's a lot of steps in Barcelona too. That would be a struggle.
It's very clear. Not a thought of cricket in my mind. Get back to England for a few days, just kicking around, get a call. Hey, what are you doing? I'm in England. They said, what about you come to Ireland? So I said, okay. Off I fly to Ireland, pumping around there. Again, I haven't done anything cricket related. I was recovering from a little injury, so just sort of pumping around, not really doing much. Get a message.
What does pumping around mean? What do you mean you're pumping around cricketer?
Because I know guys who've been doing that. It's different.
Yeah. Yeah.
Each to their own.
Yeah.
Of course.
What are you talking about? Yeah. Just in Barcelona, Ross Lambert, just pumping
show now,
around.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah. I hope you weren't pumping around in Ireland.
He said it twice.
Pumping around means. I was just kicking back.
It's too late. It's too late. It's out there. You were pumping around.
We're on holidays.
Yeah.
You're pumping around in Barcelona. Yeah. You're pumping around Ireland.
Yeah.
Pumping cover drives.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyways, where were we? Ireland. I actually went to Kimmy's for dinner in Ireland. That was great fun. Met her fam and all that.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah,
that's nice.
Beautiful. Sorry.
How was that?
That's all right. You got to play for Australia.
No, yeah, I didn't. Yeah. I was just cruising around, running drinks for Kimberly, watching her do her thing. And then, yeah, I was just laying in bed one night, got a message.
Pumping.
Hey, yeah.
Kim.
That's Kim doing that.
Yeah.
Hey, want to come play at the Phoenix? At least Perry's gone down. I said, are we sure? Are we sure I'm the right person? And then I said, okay, let me check a few things. I had to ring back home and be like, am I allowed to play cricket at the moment? Because I haven't been doing much. They said, yeah, go for your life. Off I went.
What do you mean, are you allowed to play cricket?
Because I was like coming back from a little injury.
It's like a workload thing or whatever.
It's a loads thing, right?
Loads.
Yeah, loads.
All that, so.
Yeah. My loads right to play cricket.
And there I was.
So you're pumping around Europe, you're worried about your loads.
Yeah. It's gone, isn't it? This is the interview's over.
Are you going to be able to air this? Are you going to? Is that?
Yeah, please. Well, we had way worse stuff last week.
Worse things have been said on that couch recently. Yeah.
What have you guys been up to? Oh shit!
I wonder. Like, I looked at your Cricket Victoria profile, and it says your nickname is Freddie.
Yeah,
is that pretty cool?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, Tess Flintoff, like Andrew Flintoff, right?
Uncle Freddie.
Yeah.
Uncle Freddie.
He's my uncle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. I used to get away with that for a while.
Once removed, isn't it?
Yeah, once removed.
Once removed, yeah.
Cousins.
I get all of that with Elise. Yeah. As well.
Yeah. Of course. You can't look alike. Don't you reckon?
Yeah.
Uncle Pez. Pez.
Pezzy. Pez.
Someone clip that up. Well, grade cricket was mentioned earlier, Kim. I actually noticed that on your Twitter background pic, it's of you draped in a Premier's flag at Junction Oval after having presumably won a premiership with Dandenong. If you hadn't won the premiership, that would be strange. Are you aware that once you play for Australia, you don't have to regard grade cricket anymore? You're above it.
Yeah, you got out.
You made it out of the prison.
Yeah. Maybe I should change that. What should I change it to? What do you guys reckon?
Gujarat.
No. Gujarat's gone. Gujarat days are over. Yeah. What do you guys reckon I should?
No, I was more like, if it was more an invitation for you to say, no, I actually really like playing grade cricket. It's really good.
No, but if you were telling me what I need to do with my social media, so what are you suggesting?
Whites. Oh, well.
Come on then,
well.
Picking whites.
Mm.
Whites, yeah, that would be cool.
That would be cool.
What would it be? I mean, a Twitter background pic is pretty like,
yeah, I don't,
you
don't
have to only
Twitter
look
much
at it through desktop and stuff as well. You don't even get it.
What's the profile pic out of?
What is the profile pic?
I genuinely can't remember.
Oh, it wasn't a big grade.
When you play grade cricket, like your eyes are drawn to any grade cricket pick and what someone's actually doing.
Of course.
To be fair, that was one of my favourite. Like, that was a really, really good day. It was actually a good story behind that. I've got to tell it well now. We were playing in WA for Victoria the week before, and the grade cricket final was on the Sunday, and there was only one flight back to Melbourne, and it was like the Saturday night at 4 o'clock. And we got absolutely pumped on the Thursday. So myself and Nicole were like trying, like our goal was always
leaving Perth at 4.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're going to lose hours as well.
Yep.
Yeah.
Anyway, we got pumped on the Thursday. So I'm like, God, if we get pumped again on Saturday, I could probably make this great cricket final. And anyway, what was the scores?
Oh God.
We end up getting pumped.
We got
220, and then we got some early wickets. And then they made the runs pretty quick.
Yeah.
And we literally went straight off the field. Sean Graff, old Victorian general manager, drove us to the airport, weaving in and out of traffic. Anyway, ended up like making the flight. I was going through security in like full kit. Sonny's on. It was so good. Anyway, so then we rocked up to Junction Oval the next day, like pretty tired, ready to play our Premier Cricket final. Can we also just note the dedication to great cricket here as well?
Yeah.
I love playing great cricket.
Yeah.
Once upon a time.
Yeah. Pissing
rain, so we made all this effort.
Oh, it's pissing down, of course.
We got washed.
Classic.
Out.
Yeah.
Anyway, rocked up the next week, and they had all their big dogs back because their big dogs didn't bother flying back for the final.
Oh, so they were also at the ground, and they were like, we're not going. And you're like, fuck it, I'm going.
I'm going.
And it's a washout.
Who were their big dogs?
Yeah.
They had Anna Lanning.
Yeah.
And then they had a couple of girls playing for ACT.
Okay.
Anyway.
That's not Kim Garth, is it? But anyway.
Yeah.
Let's be real.
So anyway.
It's not the 31st best player in the BBL.
Yeah. No, 31st. It was 29, wasn't it?
No, you're not in it.
No, you're not in it.
Sorry.
No,
at the moment.
Anyway, rocked up the next week and we won. We were like, are you guys going to listen?
We're listening.
Nah, sorry.
It's a very good story.
That's the end of the story. We won. We shouldn't have won, but we won.
It was off the back of a hangover too, wasn't it?
We lost.
Oh, so then
we lost the WNCL final.
We got absolutely hosed.
Mm. Nick had a broken nose.
Yes.
She got punched in the nose accidentally.
Right, Nicole Fulton.
Yeah. Played the Premier Cricket Grand Final
the next day.
What do you mean she got punched in the nose?
Accident.
Okay. Someone was playing some air drums. Nicole's turned her face. He's gone to whack the cymbal. Joker and the Thief.
Oh, yeah.
Turned Nicole's nose. Crooked.
Gone. Oh, fuck.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Blood everywhere. But she rocked up the next day and they won the flag.
Yeah, we won the flag. We made like 180 and they were 1 for 100 and then the tables turned. So that was genuinely one of my favourite.
180, days. They're 1 for 100. How did the tables turn?
Enter
Kimberly Garth.
Yeah.
Nah.
Here we go.
Yeah, Yeah, I took a couple there.
What's this story really about?
No, Kimberly.
Kimberly has led us here very expertly. No, I'm going to ask for specific figures and everything.
50 and 4 for 2 medals. That's okay.
50 and 4.
Two medals. Fucking hell. And they're building the statue right now.
If you actually look closely at that picture, I've got like best on grand in my left pocket and then just
real team player in the pocket.
What's it called?
The Premiership Medallion.
Premiership Medallion.
Whatever they call it.
Yeah, whatever they call it. Yeah. It was just another medal for the trophy room.
Yeah. I actually have a coal sore in that picture as well. So
it's really unfortunate.
Yeah, it is. It's awful. But I just thought it was good. Me and two good mates. Dandy flag. Yeah.
It's beautiful, really.
It's a good pick, actually. Yeah,
that's pretty good. That's pretty good.
That's good. That.
It's good memes.
Kim, you're really alpha. Like, and I wouldn't even say low key. Like, you're quite like, you have this persona of, I'm just going to like just critique you. But it's actually a compliment.
Okay.
You have this like genteel, soft persona. Mm. You speak very eloquently, but I can see there's a fire there.
Yeah, fast
you're
fucking stuff. Alpha. Fast bowler stuff.
Yeah, it's fast bowler stuff. Yeah. I can see the alpha in you. Another alpha in the side that you play with, Grace Harris. She's overtly alpha, right? We saw the other day where she hit a six with a fucking broken bat.
That was crazy.
But she's a really popular figure in Australian cricket. Like, she's so vivacious, generally speaking. Like, but like a real connector of people. You know, people love Grace Harris, don't they? But she's alpha.
I think, people love Grace Harris. The spectator loves Grace Harris. Mm. However, I think if you ask, she's an absolute ripper, but she does not shut up on the bench. Mm. Like, honestly. So myself
and herself.
I can say that.
Yeah, carried a fair few drinks over the last 12 months. Mm. And I have, like, she has to take timeouts. But she's really good. She's very self-aware. She'll be like, all right, I'm going over here for 5 minutes. Because she just talks and talks and talks. And like, oh my God, have you ever bowled to her? And she'll like hit you for a boundary. She'll be like, nah, through, that's four. I'm like, can you shut the fuck up? Save them. I'm like, oh, I'm not
gonna die. That's pretty good.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm going to kill this bitch. So, to be fair. She's good. And she's like box office, right? Like, her innings the other day was crazy, but she's bloody annoying to play against. And she, like, what you see is what you get with her. She doesn't put it on.
I reckon, like, when she's batting as well, like, she's obviously talking because she's mic'd up, but I can imagine her just talking through the innings generally. Like, you'd be standing at backward point, you'd be like, I can hear her fucking chatting.
Yeah. She knows exactly what she does.
Do you spray her? Like, do you just want her? Like, just, I mean, you just said here, like, away from her, I want to kill this bitch. Yeah. Like,
she's very funny.
I know,
she's
a figure, funny. It's a figure of speech. Yeah. I want to kill this bitch. But, do you ever just want to spray it? Like, just go, like, can you shut the fuck up? Like,
nah, because I think it would just, like, if you interact with her, then she'd just
love
go more.
Yeah, she is, And she bloody hits a clean ball, as we saw the other
day. She's a great cricketer.
She's good striker of a cricket ball.
So I've got a question generally about, like, rivalries in the WBBL, because strikes me that you're all such good mates, really. You don't really dislike that many people, apart from you two, obviously hate each other. But but like, you know, these rivalries, you know, like the Sydney Smash between the two Sydney sides, you know, the Stars and the Renegades, you know, that sort of confected rivalry. But like, I see the two teams just like chatting all the time. You get along so well. So the rivalries don't really exist, do they? Because you're all mates. Who do you hate?
Yeah, and who's the worst in the comp?
Who are the top 30 people you hate in the WBBL?
Oh my God. I feel like the Melbourne Derby isn't as big as it should be because of the Victorian friendliness.
Yeah.
We are Victorian, like, as a team, the Victorians are very close, but we also have most of the Victorians on, like, play for Stars. There's only like a couple of them that play for Renegades. But like, obviously on the day, we're like, we want to beat these bitches.
Yeah.
But then-
Yep,
of course.
We would also be quite friendly with them after the game.
Yeah.
Slash during the game, slash before the game. To your point, I think you're right.
I think we love beating
the Heat.
The Heat.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't think anyone likes the Heat.
Because of Grace Harris.
No. Queenslanders. No.
Queenslanders.
Queenslanders.
And like, I'm not saying they're not nice people.
Yeah. I keep
just
going.
Just like together, really nice people separately, but together you're just like, really want to beat them.
It's like Americans, really, you know, like one-on-one, perfect. But you get more than two and it's like, what's this?
Yeah,
like that. Mm. The Yanks.
Well, there goes the American tour we had playing pairs. I'm sorry about that. A bit of chat at the moment about the length of the WBBL. I don't have is it 67 games? The
59.
Length? 59, thank you. Wow, okay,
yeah,
Pezza.
Well,
the AFP will be coming soon. So the World Cup is there's in the Men's World Cup at the moment is 47 games, and that started like 3 years ago, and it's got a month left. So 59 games for the WBBL. People have been saying, "Fuck, it's a lot of games, a lot of games, guys." What do you guys? How do you guys feel about it as players? Is it too long? Would you like it a bit shorter?
I think the general consensus among most people is 10 games would be, as in at the moment it's 14.
10 games each.
14
yeah.
per team.
Yeah.
And I think 10 would be optimal.
Okay.
But we can understand why domestic players don't want it to go down, because that leaves obviously four less games. So if they can find...
Are you putting yourself in the international category now?
No, I'm a domestic player. I'm speaking on behalf. Yeah,
she kind of spoke down on that, didn't she?
I'm speaking on behalf of the domestic players.
Yes.
We would like...
What number would you bat for Australia?
Four games.
Six.
To be elsewhere.
Six. I love it.
Yep.
Who would you replace on the Aussie side?
Nobody. Never playing for
Australia. Who's targets on the back?
What's happening?
Well, when I was like with Midge and the severed artery or whatever, and you know, Elise has been going around for a while, and Meg's been going around for a while. So like, time for someone else to get a fucking go. Yeah.
let's get some young blood in there, you know.
Yeah, I think fuck with Kate maybe, but
nah. Yeah. Tess is watch this space, genuine.
Okay,
she's gonna be.
Well, the space I watched was or maybe you told us about it. Speaking of great cricket on your side, Tess is you're Ringwood, right?
Do you love know where Ringwood is? Do you know where Jubilee Park is?
I love Ringwood. We're playing there on the 8th of November.
Okay.
For its day.
For Stars.
3 p.m.
For the Stars.
Oh, yeah. Sick.
Stars versus Sixers.
Yep.
My home ground.
Okay.
That's nice. Can you first tell us about your love for Ringwood? A lot of people would be curious about that.
Oh, yeah. Incredible place.
Yep.
We've just, we've actually got a new facility there. We've got indoor nets. We've got That's a new awesome. Pavilion.
That's impressive.
It is a beautiful ground.
Named after you?
Could be on the cards.
She's
not kidding. No, it's not.
You got your face plastered up.
Yeah,
She's kind of like the Sophie Molyneux of Dundee, I reckon.
Yeah,
she's got a lot of. She's a big face when you go through the gates. That's a bit like Tessa Ringwood.
Well, your brother plays there, right?
He does play there. In the twos.
Pardon?
In the twos.
In the twos.
Yep.
He has played a game of ones, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Well, he has.
How did I
believe at Ringwood they present. Debutant first graders.
That's right.
With a cap.
That's
who
right.
Presented, yeah. Who presented him with his cap?
I really thought this was going to be a good idea. I presented his cap.
So good.
Yeah.
And I'm the alpha.
Yeah.
That is alpha.
It's nice.
I can see why.
He's older than you. He's 20. So
he got his first grade cap from his youngest.
6 or 7 years older than me.
Yep.
6, 7 years old, he got his first grade cap from his younger sister. Yeah. Firstly, gorgeous and beautiful at the normal, everyday human level. And now let's acknowledge that. That's a beautiful thing.
Let's get that
Parents
out of the way.
Very proud.
Yep.
Yeah.
A wonderful moment. That's beautiful.
Families involved.
Great. I got kids.
Community.
I couldn't think of anything better.
Et cetera, et cetera.
Done. But he's got his first... it's his highest attainment in cricket.
Yeah.
And then his younger sister goes, "Well done, champion."
Yeah, well done, champion.
Your cap.
Honestly. Yeah.
What did you actually say?
Good
did
on
you,
your champion.
Yeah, yeah, good.
Can we do like?
I swore on it. It actually did the rounds. I think My Cricket posted a snippet of it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
My mom told me off for swearing.
What'd you say?
You can say it here.
I said something along the lines of, "Nothing you haven't faced in the backyard." Had a little dig. And then I think I finished it off with, "For fuck's sake, play straight." He tends to just go across it a little bit.
Yeah.
Does he fall over a bit?
Left-hander.
He's a left-hander.
He's looking at work. Yeah.
And I think he copped a little bit of stick out there. Again, I still think
that's perfect.
It was such a good idea, but...
I still think it's a good idea.
Yeah. Well played.
It's been and gone, hasn't it?
Mm.
Anyways.
Do you fuck around with grey cricket anymore or...?
I do. I love the Rams. I play there whenever I can.
Oh, I love that.
Can you ask me when was the last time you played for the Rams?
Yeah. When was the last time you played for the Rams, Tess Flintoff?
I think it was round one last year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we won both games.
Get any?
Both T20s. Got a few. We actually played against Kimberley.
Yeah, we did. You barbecued someone, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. But
we
won the game.
That was pretty funny. Yeah. You were there at the end.
We went on to win the T20 final at Junction. So
you playing? Okay.
We?
Loads.
Loads.
So you couldn't
loads.
Play.
Pump it
wanted
around.
To.
Well, you were pumping around Europe at the time, of course. Yeah. Yeah. Which can happen.
Yep. Anyways.
There'd be a lot. I want to ask this question. There'd be a lot of people listening to this podcast who don't engage with women's cricket, rightly or wrongly, probably wrongly. And I want to ask, like, what are some of the worst, apart from questions we've asked, but like some of the worst questions you've got from like uninformed dinosaur-esque men about women's cricket or worse things said. I'm thinking things like, you know, who's your favourite men's player? From an educational perspective is really what I'm asking. Like, what's some of the stuff you're like, that's grim. Please don't, you know, do
the
that.
Girls would, nah, I can't.
And who is your favourite men's player?
Favourite men's player?
Don't answer that.
Peter Siddle. It's so random.
Sam Perry's my favourite men's player.
Yeah.
Pez. Uncle Pez.
Yeah. Uncle Pez, yeah.
And niece Elise is probably my favourite player. Pezzy.
Pezzy. Yeah.
The Elise Perry.
Can you say what you're going to say?
Nah. Actually. Okay, I'll say. You get like, do women wear boxes a bit?
Oh, okay. You said boxes, and I was actually thinking about like the silk underpants, you know? A women's box, yeah. Is that what you mean? Yeah,
that a bit.
All right.
And then, does it hurt if you get hit in the tit?
Does it hurt? Yeah. You get that question from people.
I've never got that question. Maybe.
Does it hurt if you get hit in the tit?
You can ask a brack, maybe.
I reckon you said that's your brother giving you his first grade cap.
Don't know that. Definitely don't know that. Really? Yeah. You do a massive racket.
Most of the questions are pretty good, though, or like.
No, you do get some like just ignorant.
Yeah.
Ignorant sort of comments. Do you?
I feel like a lot of people ask about like red ball cricket and stuff, just assuming that we play.
Yeah.
You do as an Australian player. But like. It's more so just like they got no idea what's going on, like what comps and stuff are on. And
Yeah.
Or like, oh yeah, we have to do, like sometimes, you know, you have to do those like function things and you're like, oh, you get like, oh, do you guys get paid? Like you get that a lot. Yeah, it's we do get paid. Yeah. Oh, so this is your job.
Yeah. What do you do outside of Crete? Like what do you do for work? No, like we're pretty lucky.
This is our work. That's probably the main one actually. To be fair,
we get the same question. What else do you guys do outside of this? Yeah.
Is this your full-time job?
Yeah, we've got a lot of that. Mainly for my dad, to be fair. Yeah. He says the same thing.
What's your dad's name?
Greg. Greg. Don't you say a fucking word about my dad.
Long time listener.
He doesn't listen to this. Yeah, because like with the international calendar, because obviously the national team just played against the West Indies in six games, right? The ODIs and then three T20s or other way around. And then there's the South Africa series doesn't start until like the end of January. But obviously there's a WBB on the medal, which goes for like 3 months, but it's kind of, it's like it is still intertwined in like the what's happening with the men's cricket as well, isn't it? So I'd probably have to schedule these things, but I sort of get why people don't know what's going on because it's probably too much cricket, generally speaking.
Can you tell us what you're doing over Christmas?
Yeah, there's a lot of cricket on. We have a trip to India over Christmas.
Yes.
Which, it's happening.
There's a test match, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a day-night test match, which should be really cool.
Whereabouts is that?
I believe Mumbai.
Okay.
Don't think it's been finalized, but I think that's the word on the street.
Well, that'd be unbelievable. Day-night test match,
yeah.
Mumbai.
Yeah.
Can we talk about Kimmy with a pink ball?
Yeah.
Does that not excite you?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You've never seen me bowl.
Holy moly.
Never seen you bowl. I was at the game the other day.
Oh, yeah. So, we waved. Hey, Bez.
Yeah.
Uncle Bez.
Yeah. You were leaving during the innings break.
My boys were so tired. Seriously.
Tired, were they? Oh, yeah. That old
always blame it on the kids, you know?
Too much fucking
around. Yeah.
Litchfield's out. I've seen enough.
Yeah. Fair enough. Yeah, it hurts. No,
what sort of decks do you think the BCCI are going to prepare to make it difficult?
Because last time we were there, although I actually, all T20s, I've only ever played T20s in India, but they have all been incredibly flat with like 55 meter boundaries, like bowler's nightmare. But test match, I've got absolutely no idea. But yeah, the schedule is pretty, it's hectic. So I can see why people would get confused with like what's going on and that kind of stuff. Because we've got Big Bash into India, into South Africa at home, into Bangladesh away, into IPL or something like that. So,
yeah.
But it's very exciting for women's cricket. It's what we've been asking for. So
yeah, absolutely. Last one for me, guys. I know the Big Bash has just started, long season to go, but who's the team to beat? Would you say it's the Adelaide Strikers, seeing as they fucking rolled you for 29?
Nah, don't rate him.
I love that. Well, you didn't play.
Didn't get you, did they test? Mm. Didn't get you?
I rolled for 86 yesterday.
Mm.
Who's a team to beat? Is it the Stars?
I genuinely think it's hard to tell this year. The draft has made it very, very even. I think the Heat, as much as we like beating them, they are a hard team to beat. Yeah.
Yep. I suppose the Sixers now as well without Elisa.
Yeah, we've already beaten them.
You did.
Well, that's what I want to finish
you didn't
with.
Play.
Yeah. First game of the year against the Sixers. Last ball, 4 to win. Alice Capsey to Lindsay Smith.
What?
Bowls one of the greatest wides you've ever seen. Not given did that just make victory ever so sweeter?
Mm.
Yes. I'm going to say yes.
All admitted in the sheds, obviously, that was just one of the greatest wides of all time. Did the umpire join you in the sheds after? I support the Sixers, by the way.
Yeah, we won't tell them about that, will we?
Yeah. Keep that on the down low.
I was actually spinning because I bowled the wide probably like three overs before and it wasn't a wide. So I'm like, well, if that's not a wide, why was my That was my question. But, that was a great win. We probably shouldn't have won that game. But we ended up pulling it out of nowhere, / they kind of threw it away. So we'll take it. So 1-1. Big game, Sarva. So hopefully once this airs, you guys can debrief a win and a few nice away swingers, maybe.
Okay. Poles up front.
Yep, poles up front. How do you guys feel about this interview just while we're on air? How do you feel it's gone?
Really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Don't you reckon?
It's been fun.
Yeah, it was
I think good. It's the couch has made it really relaxed.
Yeah, it's been good.
Love this couch.
What do you think about the studio generally?
Not a bad little setup.
I thought it was going to be bigger, to be honest.
Really?
Like, I remember we were just walking down the street and then boom, these two Muppets in the window. Oh, we're here.
Hey, guys. Yeah. I thought I was going to
also two blokes who are like researching you guys as well.
Yeah, like Google Open, Tess Flintoff. So actually, maybe you guys are those ignorant people that ask really silly questions about women's cricket. If you're good,
do you think we hit it well?
Yeah. No, I think you've been pretty good.
I actually didn't realize you guys were coming in today. I was just looking up stats.
Mm. Fair enough.
Nerd.
Nah, it's good. Studio's good.
Yeah, love it here.
Yeah, good interview.
Can't wait to put a little stars, something or other up.
Yeah, can get.
Well,
some,
you can anytime. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know where we are now.
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
Conveniently.
Mm. Yeah. Now we'll be back if you'll have us.
There.
Depends.
So we just want to keep this awkwardness going. Yeah. So this is
no, cool. No one's saying anything to sign it off.
Yeah, let's have 10 seconds of silence now.
Okay, I can do this.
3, 2, 1, go.
Pumping around Europe.
Couldn't do it. Tess Flintoff, Kim Garth, thanks so much.
10 seconds.
Oh. Right.
Alpha. Fucking alpha.
Just over the top.
Yeah. Wait, do you want to tell them the alpha theory about the happy birthday? Nah, we'll keep that for another time.
What is it?
We've got a theory.
Two hip hips.
Yep. So you know when you say happy birthday, whoever says hip hip is the alpha.
Yep.
Oh,
so
it's good
if you ever want to test
two.
The alpha.
And always give it two.
Yeah.
Really?
Then everyone just
that is very, like, see, that would tick me off for the rhythm of the song.
And then everyone just
because the song only resolves once the third hip hip is announced, you know, is roared.
Exactly. So if you just
so you like to be the alpha, firstly you do it and second you only offer two.
Yep.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Use that one.
That'll
you're going to play 500 games for Australia.
Yeah, that's the sort of stuff the audience want to hear.
Oh, nice, thanks.
Did you do that to your older brother?
Made the team sing happy birthday.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's good. Well, there's a lesson. Just two hip hips.
Two hip hips.
That's really good.
And be the hip hipper.
Yeah, always be the hip hipper.
Because then someone else would have felt alphaed by them not saying the hip hip.
Yeah.
And then the third one's left out and then they'll sort of, like someone might awkwardly go like,
exactly.
Oh, and it just dissolves.
It's good. It's so
a ruined birthday song.
Yeah, nothing better. And it brings the attention back to you as well.
Yeah, and it brings the attention back to you. Yeah, that's 600 games.
600 games, fucking hell, I'm excited.
Tess Flintoff, Kim Garth, thanks so much.
Thanks for having us, guys. Thank you very much, guys. Fun.
Thank you very much to Kim and Tess for their time this morning before they go and play a game against a team that bowled them out for 29 a few days ago. Hashtag AskTJC. Pezza is brought to you by Ponting Wines. You can use the code GET A FEW, all one word, all capitals, if that's your preference, for 20% off at pontingwines.com.au. I was just looking through the selection, as is my want at this time of the week, Pezza. Ponting Milestone 257 Tasmania Pinot Noir. Do you remember last Friday? Hell of a week last Friday. Mm. Hell of a week for TJC, just generally speaking, last week. So we knocked the top off a couple of Ponting wines,
didn't we?
In the studio, sat in the sun, bathed in the sunshine, indeed, just to reflect on the week that was. Had a Ponting wine milestone 257 Tasmania Pinot Noir. I'm looking at Ricky Ponting's comments here about the 257. So the entire wine range for Ponting wines, you can find at pontingwines.com.au. reflect on some point in Ponting's career. So the milestone 257 refers to the milestone innings of 257 versus India at the MCG, 2003 Boxing Day. Here are Ricky Ponting's quotes. India were the toughest of competitors. This made scoring my highest test score of 257 and back-to-back double centuries in consecutive tests a truly cherished milestone of my career. Bravo, Ricky Ponting. Bravo. That is absolutely sensational. Ben Riggs, who makes the wines for Ponting Wines, says the 257 is made in a style to reflect the best of Tasmania. Ricky and I selected a single site in Meadowbank to create a milestone-worthy Pinot Noir. Pezza, when we were sitting in the office there, bathing, basking in the sunlight.
Yeah.
Of Melbourne's one and only sunlight for That's a couple. Right.
Melbourne at 21 degrees. Fantastic.
I mean, we're still wearing jumpers and the heater was on.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it was nice to get some vitamin D on the old epidermis there. But it was glorious, wasn't it? Having a little Ponting wine.
It's a genuinely good drop.
Use the code GETAFEW for 20% off at pontingwines.com.au. We keep talking about it every week. People are saying, is it actually? It actually bloody is. It's good. Pontingwines.com.au.
Hashtag ask, did you see? Here goes.
Please.
To finish things off, this is from Anon. But I play wheelie bin park shit, and so I'm firmly in the bleak realm of not only having no tees provided, but also having to umpire our own games.
Yuck.
Mm. To be perfectly honest, I don't mind it. It gives me a chance to feel even remotely involved in the game when I inevitably get bowled early doors and would otherwise just be sitting around on the boundary having to listen to my teammates whine about how unlucky they were to get out, despite clearly just having woefully inadequate skills, technique, mentality and fitness. To squeeze some worthiness and satisfaction from my Saturday, I particularly enjoy taking on the role of pious prick when umpiring, suddenly rising from being just one of the players to being the self-appointed lord of the game, immediately adopting a posher accent despite being firmly council estate working class to say unnecessarily formal things. Middle, that is, the action is right arm over. Two balls to come. Play. I was thinking about doing that in the posh accent. I don't think I can. All while cradling the bowler's jumper draped over my arm with my hands clasped together in front of me, yes, like an old man staring at a museum exhibit. I particularly take issue when a bowler doesn't say please or thank you and simply hands me their shitty hat to hold. Like some old schoolmaster, I demand a please or thank you. Where has this even come from? I hate myself. That's probably not just limited to my umpire self, to be honest. Anyway, on this occasion, we are unbelievably chasing a total of 90-odd to win. I'm in at 3, and true to form, I'm swiftly bowled cheaply. I go out to umpire, summoning my inner prick as I collect my 6 stones. We're stumbling, a few more go down. We cannot suffer the indignity of not winning this game when chasing 90. Our middle order stick is shuffling the score along, but is trapped on the crease. Reed swipes and misses a slow, straight one. I do the only thing I can at this level. Following the time-honoured code, I'm umpiring my own side. LBWs are not a thing. I have to shake my head in spite of their multiple zealous appeals just meters from my face and the fact that delivery was very obviously going on to hit halfway up middle. Next over, the same thing happens. I look into the faces of the eager appealers, my inner monologue sighing. Sorry, boys, we can't lose this. I shake my head again, eyes closed, chin slightly protruding. God, I hate myself again. The middle order stick in question eventually limps to 30-odd not out and gets the winning runs. As we regather on the boundary, he is milking it beyond belief. He's acting like he's Ben Stokes at Headingley 2019, talking us through the innings and how he kept his head while all around him lost theirs, his bravery, his recharacterising streaky edges as delicate late cuts, all while sipping a cold one that appears to have manifested from someone's kit bag. I sat quietly listening, fiddling with my stones and packing away my barely used kit. He was apparently oblivious to the fact he had obviously been out twice. I opted not to join the boys back at the club to hear more about his momentous knock. My question is this. Did I do the right thing by staying quiet to allow this cuck to enjoy his fantasy moment in the sun in the hope that someday someone would do the same for me? Or should I have pissed all over his chips by letting him know he's actually dog shit and was out twice? And that it wasn't for, and if it wasn't for my grubby lack of any fair play or sportsmanship, he would have been heading back to the boundary for 8. Secondarily, why does umpiring immediately make me a prick? And finally, and obviously, why can't it be me hitting the winning runs?
It's an interesting question, Pezza, about what kind of umpire do you want? Do you want an umpire that thinks that the entire thing is set up for him? Mm. Is the whole weekend set up for his involvement in the sport?
Yes.
Or is someone so removed from the actual participation of what's happening before their eyes that you might as well have a piece of shit in a sock standing there? You know, which umpire do you want? You know, someone who gives nothing or someone who gets themselves into the narrative of your weekend? Which one do you want?
I'm prepared to leave that as the end of the show.
Thanks for joining us on this show. Everyone's been in the studio. Everyone's been on Zoom. Thank you so much for sticking with us. It's been a long one, but we hope you've enjoyed it. See you on the internet real soon. Cheers.